isn't responding.
Bravo?
Still nothing.
You lost both teams? Get a grip on this operation, Heather. That's Bourne.
Green light, yes, sir.
Sir, I need more time.
We have no time.
Are you going to give that order or not?
Sir, please.
You're too naive to see the truth.
There's no bringing in Bourne. He has to be put down. And you obviously cannot do what has to be done.
I am taking operational control.
Asset, you have a green light.
Repeat, you have a green light on Bourne.
Copy that.
We will defend these police officers.
Listen to police officers' commands, listen to what we tell you, and just stop. The nation needs to realize that when we tell you to do something, do it. And if you're wrong, you're wrong. If you're right, then the courts will figure it out.
We don't get to pick the law. We enforce them. But at the end of the day, each and every member is to go home safe. Sometimes the use of force is necessary. You need to comply with the police officer the way the system was meant to be. Comply with the orders of police officers. Resisting arrest is a real and dangerous crime.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All. I'm your host, Dave Bourne, and it is August 18th, 2016, and I'm coming to you live from Las Vegas, Nevada. Thank you for tuning in to Nonpartisan Liberty for All. We're on weeknights, Tuesday through Thursday at 7 o'clock Pacific, 10 o'clock Eastern, and you can listen live on Spreaker.com and NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com. And to the archives immediately following the show on Spreaker, YouTube, Twitter, Tumblr, and SoundCloud, as well as the next day on Stitcher and iTunes. On Nonpartisan Liberty for All, we promote the ideas of true freedom and liberty and self-ownership, meaning being able to do whatever you want as long as you respect the freedom of others and don't directly interfere with their freedom, exposing government for what it is, a mafia based on extortion that rules without consent by threat of force and violence. We, of course, are always happy to hear from you via phone. The number is 702-470-7664 or Skype username Nonpartisan Liberty for all one word. And you can also check us out at NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com, which has not only that information, but also links to all of our social media, as well as editorials, articles, and other fun stuff. So tonight we are going to be joined by Dale Brown of the Detroit, the commander of the Detroit Threat Management Center. I don't know if something has come up. Of course, being the commander of his and owner of his company there in Detroit, I'm sure, you know, when emergencies come up, that's got to take precedence over calling in, so or he might just be wrapping things up quickly before he calls in. So what before he calls in or Skypes in, he's been on the show before, but to give a quick summary before he calls in, what he's done is create the Detroit Threat Management Center, which essentially a lot of libertarian groups and libertarian shows are, I hate to define any thing as quote unquote libertarian or use any definition for that matter, especially because of the bastardization of so many different definitions. Even the word freedom has been all fucked up, to be honest. But he's been on a whole bunch of those type of shows, or voluntarist shows. I guess you can pronounce that a couple of different ways. Voluntarist or voluntarist or whatever you want to call it. He was on Jeff Berwick's Anarchast. He's been on a number of not only YouTube shows, but local stuff in Detroit. And I think some national radio as well. So he's done a lot of stuff. We had him on the show about a year and a half ago. Initially is when I had him on. And that's episode 127. If you want to go back and listen to that, unfortunately, the audio quality is not what it is now. It was right before I kind of switched everything over. It's passable. I mean, it's fine to listen to, but it's just not the audio quality that we have now, just to let everybody know, so they're aware. But it was still, he was great on the show, a lot of information and stories. Also, starting September 12th, Dale is going to start his own show on the network every Monday at 5:30 Pacific, 8:30 Eastern, the Threat Management Center show, Public Safety Through Nonviolence, and that's going to be weekly on Mondays, again, at 5:30 Pacific, 8:30 Eastern, and that's going to begin on September 12th. So there's still a while until that starts. I wanted to announce that today, and we'll talk a little about that when Dale calls in. And, you know, what he plans on talking about on the show. We're still kind of in, you know, talking about things and whatever, but it's ultimately up to whatever he wants to talk about. And hopefully, and I think he mentioned that this would be something he wanted to cover, his philosophy within the organization and how he, what his philosophy is and how he came up with that, as well as he has tons of stories that he can tell, and, you know, things continue, of course, to go on. And the message of safety and protection and being able to do that in a nonviolent way. So it will definitely be a very entertaining show. And, you know, I'm looking forward to it, not only as a producer of the show, but as a listener as well. I've talked to Dale a number of times, not only on the show we did, but off air. And he just has so many, 20 years of stories. He had started, I believe, in 94 or 95 with just a shotgun or a rifle and a dog. And he had come from a well-off family in Ann Arbor, Michigan, which is also the home of University of Michigan, for all the Ohio State fans out there. And he described his suburban type of life. I guess he went to military school. I had heard on another show, we never got into it for a year. I believe it was only a year, freshman year, but pretty much grew up in Ann Arbor, Michigan, and then had joined the military, was a paratrooper, and really just wanted to help people. And he didn't want to go to college. He ended up going to Detroit. He came from a family of doctors. I guess even his sister is a doctor, and ended up, you know, taking something that he was passionate about, protecting people, seeing all these things that were going on, and seeing what was happening and wanting to do something about it and not getting in it for money or anything like that. I mean, he's even said in a number of interviews that he thought he was going to be dead by a certain point. So, you know, the money that he started making, he just spent it because he was like, well, you know, I'm pretty much probably going to be dead because of the situations he was facing. And we're talking about Detroit that got rid of a whole bunch of officers. I don't think initially when he started, but I know they have in the past, what, 5-6 years, definitely. I don't know when they started with going towards bankruptcy, which where they were talking about declaring bankruptcy. I don't know when they started down that path of laying officers off or not having enough officers, but the stories that he's told on my show and a number of other shows and that I've heard personally, it's just, it's crazy. I mean, it really is. So it's definitely, you know, great that he's agreed to do a show on the network. And I know it will not only be entertaining, and you want to, I mean, obviously, if you don't entertain people and they're bored, they're not going to listen. But at the same time, there's a lot of information and a lot of things that I believe people can learn from him being on the show. And speaking of shows, I apologize. Yesterday, I think I had mentioned on Tuesday that I've been having some stomach issues, and yesterday was just really bad. So I missed yesterday's show, which we'll be doing on Tuesday regarding Black Lives Matter and their platform that they've put together that is being funded. I've heard it's being funded by people like George Soros, but that's the name that everybody always goes to. They always go to Soros. But I really think that it's being funded by political operatives. It's turned into something totally different than what the original issue is, and that's the police and the issues with the police. And anybody who's listened to the show before knows how I feel about the police. I don't think they should exist. And I know that Dale has, you know, fears about other companies that handle security and don't have the same mentality that they have. And definitely, I mean, you look at just security in general, any company that has security, whether they work directly for the company or they're supplied by a security company, I mean, they don't pay them anything. A lot of them are wannabe cops. And you could tell just by their general attitudes that they are wannabe cops. And, you know, I see some, I don't want to say, well, I guess I don't really say where I work. So I mean, they have security guards at work. I can tell which ones are, you know, have that attitude and whatnot. And I'm sure they're paid no more than $15 an hour, if that. And one of the points that he's made is that you're going to pay somebody, you know, an amount that they can barely live on to protect valuables. I mean, what do you expect? They don't have training. They're not willing to give their life. I mean, why would somebody, you know, getting paid $15 an hour? And it shouldn't be about the money anyway. But at the same time, they use security really because, of course, in Las Vegas, I mean, there's security everywhere, at least on, you know, the Strip. there's security at every casino. I don't mean there's security everywhere, meaning, you know, neighborhoods and when you get away from the strip or downtown. But what I mean is there's a lot of security jobs because every casino has a whole bunch of security. I know they're going a lot to using technology more and more, but they all have security guards. And a lot of them, again, I mean, they're barely making anything. They're usually they don't even have armed security, or they're armed but with non-lethal weapons, which is a positive thing because, again, I don't think they know what they're doing. And they definitely, I mean, they're no comparison to Dale's team and what they do. It's a totally different thing. These are just people that are reporting stuff to the police, basically, at the casinos. And I think that's they're willing to, I think, do that and do that based on having the police as a backup. But if they didn't have the police as a backup, that's when you go into, well, how would things change in the security business? And of course, I'm sure you have, when you're talking about bodyguards and things like that, that protect celebrities and those type of people, I'm sure they get paid pretty well. And I know Dale has done that before in the past. But when you're just talking about regular security, and I got in an argument, I remember, with a security guard at the Stratosphere because I pulled into when I was pulling into the fucking pulling into the casino, but not like I was driving through the door into the casino, but pulling in, and then I turned around in this area that was cement, but I guess it was a walking area, but nobody was on it. And this guy comes over, starts yelling at me, like talking down to me. And I'm like, fucking, you know, who the fuck are you? Stop yelling at me. I don't remember exactly what I had said to him, but the attitude, it's like, you're nobody. You know, the only thing you can do is call the police, or, you know, which they're just going to tell me to leave. So really, you can just tell me to leave for what? Because I didn't realize something. So that's the type of attitude I think you get from these untrained security guards. And a lot of them have these attitudes. And I even thought about making a complaint, but I didn't. And I prefer, of course, security to police. However, not that type of security. And that's where teams like Dale's, and if they could adopt the same type of philosophy and start other security companies. I mean, I obviously want to see Dale expand and continue to be successful and be more successful, but to also have a market of competitors that are able to do what he's able to do. But, you know, he's the best out there. And usually, I know he had talked about some racist companies and things like that that wouldn't hire him because of that, and that's fucked up. But he is definitely, there's nobody that does what he does, and he's the best out there. And that's why he gets the attention that he does, because there's nobody that does what he does. And that's why, again, I don't like to use labels, but libertarians or anarchists or people that look at or think about society's voluntarist societies and things like that, where you don't have your money extorted to pay police, and that you have groups that are held accountable. Now, they do a totally different thing. They are not police. They do not arrest people. They do not do the same functions or focus on the same things that police do. You know, they focus on protection and safety and prevention in a way that is, I mean, Dale would have to explain the way he does it, and I've heard him talk about it, but I mean, they're respectful to everybody. They try to, not try to, but basically operate in that way. And use it to deter crime at the same time. So he gave an example of somebody just walking down the street, and then from that, you know, talking to that person, telling them, you know, just being friendly and that, hey, we're out here, you know, protecting things and whatnot, and that whole thing. And essentially, from what he was saying, you know, this person might have been looking for trouble, but or looking for people to rob or whatever. But after that interaction, if that guy was going to do anything, he's not going to do it there. So he didn't have to take out a gun or threaten anybody or use any force or do anything like that in order to prevent a crime from taking place. If, you know, assuming that a crime was going to take place, and we don't know that that's the case, but from what he was saying, it seemed like it was. So I'm going to take a break, try to get in touch with Dale. Hopefully we can get him on in the next few minutes or so, or at least by the time we get back. And I'm going to play some clips, some from the Detroit Threat Management Center, as well as other police oriented clips. So we will be back right after this. NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com. Check us out, and we'll be right back, and hopefully with Dale Brown of the Detroit Threat Management Center.
This episode of Cop Block is brought to you by FreeKeen.com.
In February of 2012, I posted a write-up to CopBlock.org titled, "Frustrated, Detroit Residents Compete with Police." Included in the story was a picture of Dale Brown, founder of the Threat Management Center. A year later, when I knew I was to roll through Detroit as part of the Cop Block tour, I reached out to Brown, who graciously welcomed me at his facility and shared with me some of his time and knowledge. It was definitely worth a stop.
My name is Dale Brown, founder of the Threat Management Center, located in Detroit. What Threat Management Center represents in general is how to properly manage human threats to create the most nonviolent outcome possible. I started in 1995 in the security capacity, helping the community deal with violent criminals. We're doing home invasions and murders in our area. I would call police, I would constantly reach out, and what I found was there was a general apathy and complacency where law enforcement was just not interested as a group. There were certain officers that were motivated, and those community-oriented officers bonded with our organization, and we were able to, with their assistance, create a condition where all the murders, home invasions, and other types of violent crimes stopped. The result of stopping the violence and the criminal activity was a good quality of life for the residents that lived there, which ultimately led to the building owners going into the black for the first time in 20 years. And it just took a couple of good officers, and my staff consisted initially just of me, a dog, and a rifle. And then it just grew from there. I just got volunteers from the community to help out. I got the building owners to give me one free apartment in each building and a small financial stipend. It didn't take much money, but it took lots of self-sacrifice. The key was to put the protection of the families before my own and to think about one thing, which was good quality of life for the people there. And the way to do that was to use not the legal system to prosecute people, but to prevent the conditions which led to, which could lead to, violent encounters. And that includes having heroic law enforcement officers out there putting themselves at risk, not thinking about themselves, not thinking about getting home to their family safely at night, but thinking about the citizens getting home to their families first and foremost. We need that kind of policing. The kind of policing we have right now typically is an officer thinking about their own safety, and that's what they're taught. That false thought process means they can't truly protect anyone appropriately. The cornerstone for protection is love, not violence, not guns, not laws. You cannot and you will not truly protect anything that you do not love. But if you love something, love someone, love people, you can protect them, and it starts with yourself. Having people that love themselves, love their family members, love their community, love people in general, those are the people that can protect the best, because they will put themselves at risk for others, and that is the key. That level of intention and dedication is the key to stopping violent predatory behavior. You want these predators to realize there is no way they're going to achieve violence perpetrated against families because, or the people that are there, because when the violent predator sees them, they're going to realize this person is dedicated to the safety there, and they're going to back down. And if they don't back down, that person will be able to manage threats properly if they go through our training. And that's what really separates our organization from any other, is the fact that it really is designated and designed specifically to create nonviolence, but if there is going to be violence, to make sure that you're significantly capable of managing those threats properly. We constantly recruit. We're a performance-based organization. Our bodyguard program, which is called VIPER, stands for Violence Intervention Protective Emergency Response System. The foundation for its success is in the fact that the individuals that are in our organization, in order to participate, have to be altruistic. Our lifeblood of this organization is having people that are really talented, really motivated, and highly skilled by constantly training them. And those people that do not want to train or are not good enough are replaced by better people. We are not looking for people, and we do not accept people who are human predator oriented. So people that like to fight or people that like to shoot people. A lot of times guys come back from the military organizations, and I have to be careful because we're not looking for the kind of mindset that says, you know what, it's okay to use violence as long as you can legally explain it. We're looking for people that don't want to use violence under any conditions. What we emphasize is 100 ways in a situation which would normally be fatal force oriented, 100 ways to not have a violent or fatal incident take place. We perform 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. We protect communities here in Detroit, upscale communities like Palmer Woods, Sherwood Forest, and the golf course. We have approximately 1,000 homes that depend on us for safety, responding to them and their families and their emergencies. And we have approximately 500 businesses that are our clients as well. And then the people that cannot afford our services, we help them for free. The reason that we can do that is because there is a healthy profit margin left over from excellence from providing for our major corporations. We offer free training to families. We call it Free Family Friday. Typically, the prosecutor's offices, the shelters in the area for domestic violence victims, stalking victims, are sent to us for assistance. We protect them for free. We escort them to court. If they have a violent ex-husband or boyfriend or neighbor or some stranger that's coming after them, we will literally stay with them, transport their kids to school. We stay with them at their homes with our rifles and keep them alive. And in 20 years, none of us have had a court date, and more importantly, none of us have been killed. And the most important, no one who's ever come to us for help in 20 years has ever been injured or killed after coming to this organization. On Mondays, we have a free class for any sworn law enforcement officer. We have a state trooper that I've trained for 10 years who's in charge of the law enforcement section here. And we don't believe in being weapon dependent here. Here, guns are like a first aid kit, something you should have, but not something you should depend on. When they have an option to not injure someone, often they would choose that had their training system given that to them. And so that's one of the things we do, is try to fill a person's toolbox, thinking of their mental toolbox as the toolbox that you go around answering all your questions with. We make sure that in that toolbox are so many options to create a nonviolent outcome that it's almost impossible to have violence. So we show you how to get close, how to use psychology to take that person's perspective and change it so there is no adversarial perspective. And if there is going to be one, you're so close, you can still take control of that person without injuring them. So it's all positive. Creating positive outcomes, nonviolence equals a prosperous outcome. And that's one of the things we want to encourage all communities, all corporations, law enforcement institutions to realize. It is focusing on the prevention of the conditions which leads to violence, which is the key to creating a safe, successful society.
There is a common fallacy held even by most advocates of laissez-faire that the government must.
And with me now, Milwaukee County Sheriff David Clark. Sheriff Clark, what do you say? I mean, what's your reaction to this? Is it open season on law enforcement in this country?
Judge, I am too pissed off tonight to be diplomatic about what's going on, and I'm not going to stick my head in the sand about it. I said last December that war had been declared on the American police officer led by some high-profile people, one of them coming out of the White House, one coming out of the United States Department of Justice. And it's open season right now. There's no doubt about it. Look, anytime a law enforcement officer is killed, a little of every police officer in America dies along with them.
And Sheriff, you know, as law enforcement across the country watches this, and I asked the sheriff, Sheriff Hickman in Harris County, you know, in New York and in Baltimore and in Ferguson, you know, no peace, no justice, no peace, and all the crazy marches and all the, you know, some of these organizations out there. Apparently in Harris County, this isn't something that was normal. I mean, can this happen anywhere in the country now?
Anywhere in the United States, and I'm tired of hearing people call these black activists. They're not activists. This is black slime, and it needs to be eradicated from the American society.
But how do you do
it?
How do you do it, Sheriff?
Well, here's how you do it. I need every law-abiding person in the United States of America to stand up and start pushing back against this slime, this filth, this disparaging the American law enforcement officer within these communities. When these ugly people come out and start this and start talking this stuff on social media, to push back against it and demand people that belong to these organizations to get out of their town. There's no room for it. Look, the American police officer is holding these communities together, and we need the support of the people that we defend every day in order to get that done. God bless the Harris County Sheriff's Office. Kudos to that district attorney for acknowledging the war on police. But I'm tired of qualifying all these statements by talking about bad apples within the policing profession.
All right. Sheriff, I want you to take a listen to what Ron Hickman, the Harris County Sheriff, said.
We've heard black lives matter, all lives matter. Well, cops' lives matter too. So why don't we just drop the qualifier and just say lives matter and take that to the bank?
Interesting reaction.
We need to hear more of that from everybody. I know there's been some pushback on that, and that's good. This whole movement, Black Lies, I've renamed it LIES, because it's based on a lie, the hands up, don't shoot. That's why I said this slime needs to be eradicated from American society and American culture.
And with someone like this defendant, and this is, he's charged with murder, and it is death eligible, capital murder, the killing of a police officer. You know, we saw in New York City with Ramos and Wen Jian Lu, two cops sitting in a police car, I think it was Christmas Eve, just got executed. You know, someone in New York City comes after a cop with a machete in his hands. And this is happening all over the country. I mean, what impact does this have on law enforcement? I mean, do they back off or do they just keep doing their job? Or are they like, you know what, I don't need this. We got six cops indicted in Baltimore. Why would someone even be a cop these days?
Well, we better hope that that doesn't happen for the sake of the rule of law, the sake of our way of life here in the United States. This was an assault on the American way of life, the American justice system. And if the American police officer backs off, we're all in trouble. Look, we live in a state of hypervigilance. And now we're going to have to turn that up even more. But the American police officer is strong. We will continue to fight back. We will continue to sacrifice ourselves for the good law-abiding people in every community of the United States.
And finally, Sheriff, the national rhetoric that's going on, you say that people need to push back and we need to see things when we see things on Facebook or on social media. You know, the truth is that people can say and do whatever they want. This is America. But without leadership, you know, there isn't going to be any different, you know, reaction. More people seem to be emboldened by this kind of thing.
Right. And that's why I said that the president of the United States started this war on police. Look, and I know what you mean, Judge, by that, but it's not absolute. You can't say anything you want in the United States of America. You cannot threaten people's lives. You can't call for the killing of people like we're seeing from some of these things. That is not First Amendment protection. That it protected. That is filth. That is slime. And, you know, there are some law enforcement implications that can be done with the Department of Justice and with state attorney's offices across the United States. I love the First Amendment. I love freedom of speech. You are not free to threaten my life or anybody else's.
All right. Sheriff David Clark, thanks so much for being with us tonight.
My pleasure.
All right. And with
Nonpartisan Liberty for All, and we are back. I had spoken to Commander Brown, and he will be with us momentarily. So I wanted to talk about something totally off topic that happened with me that it has no relevance to anything that has to do with the show. But so I was driving home yesterday, and I don't know why, so I had whatever station programmed. Usually I don't listen to the radio. I try to listen to talk radio so I can come and talk about some of the bullshit that they talk about. And if y'all are listeners, you've heard me talk about. So I'm getting tired of the shit that's on when I drive home from work. Even sometimes the shit that's on when I'm driving to work, because it's all about the Hillary Clinton and fucking Trump. And it's all a rigged bullshit election anyway. So even with, in the morning, Glenn Beck is on. And like I said, he's the only guy who I think actually comes off, and I say that because I have no fucking idea what he stands for really, or what he really believes, or what he says when he goes home, or whatever. But he's the only guy that comes off that I can think of as genuine, that I don't agree with him on a lot of things, but he seems like he actually wants to help, that he wants things to be positive and people be happy and prosperous and whatever. And he, of course, he has his own agenda and ideas of how to accomplish that. But these other guys just, they do the angry thing, and it's like a pattern of, I don't know who started it. Maybe Mark Levin started it. I don't know how long these fuckers have been on the air. But the angry conservative, even that fucker Wayne Allen Root wrote a book called The Angry White Man, or Angry White Man, or something like that. I know it has Angry White Man in it. I don't know if it's A Angry White Man or The Angry White Man or An Angry White Man. He's a fucking douchebag anyway. So he's on, and then some other angry guy is on the other station, and I'm just like, you know what? I can't listen to these fucking people because they just piss me off. So It depends on the day. I've been sick this whole week. I've had stomach pains for like constantly for the last couple days. Fortunately, I'm doing a little better today, but I just couldn't deal with them. So I put on, you know, there's like a hip hop station that plays like 90s and early 2000s stuff and stuff that I like, even though a lot of it's stuff that was more commercial back then. But they actually played Check the Rhyme by Tribe Called Quest, which I was surprised yesterday or the day before. I think it was yesterday. Anyway, I hit another button and it was like a pop station. But so this song comes on that sounds like a total R&B song. And this was yesterday. And I told people at work about this because it's like a big fucking thing to me. I don't know. So I'm listening to the song. It sounds like something like Usher would have done in like the mid 2000s or something. Or, you know, newer Boyz II Men type beat, at least. Because it had no drum beat. It was just like kind of R&B guitar and, you know, the R&B type singing. So I had never heard the song before because I don't listen to the radio. And, you know, with I kind of got fed up with the newer hip hop because a lot of it is just about cars and bullshit and whatever. And I grew up with stuff that I felt meant something that, yeah, they talked about some of that stuff too. And some of it was a lot of violence and things like that, but it was going against the grain. It was stuff that they were trying to stop and ban and whatever. And now it's just a lot of it's garbage. And I'm not going to say everything is. And it's still got dope beats and everything. But the lyrics are just, for the most part, except for people that have been around for a while coming out with new stuff. So plus, I don't really have the time with the show. If I'm listening to something, it's usually something that I'm educating myself on something for the show. So I don't really have time to keep up with, you know, what's new and whatever. And sometimes it's kind of disappointing because, you know, if somebody that I'm a fan of that's been around for a while comes out with a new album, I might miss it. Like Scarface from Ghetto Boys, who's been around for, you know, 20 plus years, came out with a new album and I didn't realize. And then I think I saw let me search for new albums. And I saw that he had come out with one and maybe I got it like 6 months late or something from the library. So, you know, he's still doing music, which is cool. So stuff like that, you know, I'll go get from the library or whatnot. But for the most part, I don't, you know, I'm not a fan of pop, for one. I do like R&B. I love Avant and R. Kelly and, you know, Jodeci, of course. And they finally came out with a new album for the first time in 20 years. So, like, in the 90s, I would buy so much R&B. It's not even funny. Same with hip hop. I mean, rap, whatever. I had points in my life where, you know, when I was going to school full time, working full time, where I would probably buy a CD or a couple CDs a week. Because back then, you were able to download stuff, but it was very slow and I didn't have a computer yet. So I would buy, you know, and this is when I first started with CDs, because as soon as I got a car, I started buying CDs. So I got my car that had a CD player in it, and it was late. It was like way later than most people started buying CDs. I was still buying like tapes until 1999. I have like 400 or 500 tapes. So I ended up on some pop station because I pressed one of the buttons, you know, where you program your station, and it just happened to be there. And it was a nice fucking, you know, R&B song. And I found out, so I'm like, well, you know, now you can get everything on fucking YouTube, or even download, you know, the MP3. But I wanted to listen to it again. And I listened to it this morning about, I don't know, fucking, geez, like 3 or 4 times. And then, you know, like I said, I mean, it sounds like just straight up R&B. And then I find out it's fucking Justin Bieber. And I'm like, what the fuck? So I'm like, damn, I actually like a song by Justin Bieber. And I don't know. It sounds like old school, not old school, but like I said, like some shit like Usher would have done, or, you know, just R&B that I would have bought when, you know, R&B was good. So I will admit that I like a Justin Bieber song. So I do. It's in my head right now too. It's like the lyrics suck. It's just a dumb song, but the singing's fine, and the beat is just nice. There's no beat, actually. It's just like guitar, but it's like R&B guitar. I don't know, whatever. It's what's the name of the song? Love Yourself. So I guess I'm a Justin. I'm not gonna call myself no fucking Justin Bieber fan at this point, but I do like that one song. So we have Dale with us. I guess he had an issue he had to take care of, and I'm sure, you know, I know he's in a demanding job, of course. So I'm happy to have him at all. And we started early today anyway. So although, you know, I could talk to Dale forever with all the stories and just, you know, 20 years of experiences that are just, you know, things that most people will, one, never experience in their life, and just some of the stuff is just unbelievable. Not that you wouldn't believe it, but I mean, it's just like shit out of movies. So, Dale, are you there? Let me get this. Oh, I didn't call him. So let me call Dale. I accepted his thing, and then I didn't call him, so he missed my Justin Bieber story. I meant to call him while I was telling my story, but I did not do that. I accepted the request, because the last time we had Dale on, he had called in. I don't remember why. That might have been before I had, as I said, I didn't have all the equipment. Our sound kind of, you know, sucked back then. Well, we'll wait for, it's ringing, but so I'll wait for him to pick up or call me back. But back to my, is it having trouble connecting there or what? Let me stop that and try to call again. Of course, the last thing you want when, and this is obviously a rule of radio, is silence. So I'm sitting there silent while I'm waiting for Dale to pick up. But back to, I guess, my story. I kind of look at him, I guess, like Justin Timberlake, where when Justin Timberlake was with, I can't believe I'm even talking about this shit, but when Justin Timberlake was with NSYNC, it was like shitty pop stuff. There were like one or two songs that were, you know, depending on who produced them, R&B type shit. He became a more of like the same thing. Like he got Timberland producing him, and then he became like an R&B hip hop star. So I think that's where Justin Bieber, I guess, is at now. I don't know. So I like one song, so that doesn't make me a fucking Justin Bieber fan. And it was kind of accidentally anyway. So anyway, I think we have Dale now. Dale, are you there?
Yes, I am.
Hey, so you missed my Justin Bieber story. I accidentally heard a Justin Bieber song as I'm getting sick of a lot of the political, I'll listen to like the political talk on my way home and my way to work, so then I can talk about these fuckheads when I'm on the air and the bullshit that they talk about, because some of them have a pattern. It's like the conservative, the angry conservative. You even got this guy who lives in Vegas. I've met him before. He was actually at a party I was at once, and he ran. He had the Libertarian nomination 1 year. I don't know how. Wayne Allen Root. He's a fucking douchebag anyway. So he wrote a book called Angry White Man or An Angry White Man or whatever. So I've just this week, my stomach's been bothering me. I've been in a lot of pain, and I'm like, I'm not listening to these fuckers. But I think they have like it's a radio format, the angry conservative, or the angry white conservative, and he is just an ass. And I actually said on the air, and I took it back because I was mad, because he said something one day. I'm like, I hope I fucking run into him and fucking challenge him to like take a swing at me so I can knock him the fuck out. But then I was like, nah, that was just my expression of anger through my show. Not that I'm going to get in a fight, you know, with a radio fucking guy. But anyway, I ended up listening to a Justin Bieber song. I didn't know. It sounded like, you know, some cool ass R&B from, you know, I was always into rap and R&B, and I ended up listening to that, and I like love the song now. So I guess I don't want to call myself a Justin Bieber fan, but I like a Justin Bieber song. I'm not what do they call those fucking people? Bieber something? I don't know, whatever. Anyway, I appreciate you calling in. I had talked about before you called in, kind of gave an introduction. Of course, you've been on before, and we got into a lot of detail about different things. And I also had mentioned that you're going to start your own show on the 12th. So I don't want to rehash really what I also played a clip from, I think that Pete Ayer did when he was down there from Cop Block. And I don't want to rehash what we went through before, but I still, for people that aren't familiar with your company and what you do, for you to give them a summary of that. And then maybe go into one of the things that I think is great that you do and about you personally is your philosophy and your intelligence, and you're constantly learning as you go. And I guess probably you would say evolving through your experience and experiences, which is great. And you built this philosophy, and I'm sure it continues to improve and get better. But it brought you to the whole nonviolent way of protecting people. So if you want to go explain to people what your company is and what you do, and then maybe get into the philosophy of that. And then I was thinking we could talk about some of the things that are going on and your opinions, and maybe later in the show kind of go into a co-host mode, being that you're going to be a host soon of your own show.
Yes.
And kind of talk about some different issues as well. And you know, if maybe we can get into some stories and stuff like that. And that's the whole thing that I had mentioned also, is that the thing about Dale is that you bring, and this is why I'm so excited about having you do a show and producing that show, is that you present yourself in an entertaining way, and you have a good sense of humor. But at the same time, there's so much information and ways that you can educate people, and they'll listen to you because you can entertain at the same time. It's like if you're on the radio and you're boring, which sometimes I'm sure I am, and especially when I'm on by myself, you know, people aren't going to want to listen. They're going to tune out, and my message is just going to go over their heads. But the ability to entertain and at the same time get that message across, it's like you even do that through your stories. You know, when you're talking about experiences that happen and the way you tell them, you're getting a message across as well, and it's great. But so yeah, going to explain to everyone again, at least in summary, what your company does and what you and your team do, and then the philosophy behind that, which I think is even one of the most important things.
Okay. First of all, can you hear me well?
You're a little muffled there.
Can you hear me now? Is this any better?
A little. Let me see if...
How about now? Is it any better at all?
It's about the same. Let me see if I can turn you up on Skype.
Anything? Check 1, 2, 3.
Yeah, I'll turn you up a little. But yeah, it's kind of... It's a little muffled, but it's good enough. We can hear you.
Okay.
Yeah, just here. Let me do this. That might be because of me. Are you getting an echo now?
Let's see. No, I'm not.
Okay, good. That just project and you'll be fine. And I know okay. You can. I know you can do projecting. That well.
No. Okay. So essentially, what my organization is, Detroit Threat Management Center. First and foremost, we are a school. And so that being said, we teach people how to defend themselves against violent criminals. We teach how to use psychology.
And not to interrupt, but this is something that we never talked about. That you because I listened to a whole bunch of interviews that you did too. Just because, you know, I've talked to you probably, I mean, for hours, because I had you on the show. Then I talked to you before the show. I talked to you after the show. I talked to you recently. And we get into these conversations where it's just, you know, fascinating stuff. But I listened to also all the other stuff you did, because there's just so much. You know, you got 20 years of stuff to talk about. Yeah. And you're one of the things that I didn't know was that initially you just wanted to train people, right? That you kind of were forced into the defense side, that right. you had your like training center, and then people started threatening you, and people took their kids out, and I didn't I never heard that, just because, like I said, I mean, there's so much to right. talk about, and that's why it would be great, you know, you doing a weekly show. But I've heard that on one of the other shows. So right. you initially just wanted to train people because you grew up learning martial arts, and I didn't know that your mother taught you that she was also, she's a doctor, but she was also in the military and taught you at a young age to shoot as well.
Right, right. It's all about guns, and I come from a heavy gun background.
And guns also, and doctors.
That's right. And I'm a firearms instructor, and just, you know, just guns was part of our life officially, just on the weekend. Going shooting, you know, going up north, we had a cottage, and, you know, it's just part of life. And so naturally, you know, it's part of my self-defense system. We live in America. There's lots of guns. So it worked out perfectly. Martial arts and guns, the understanding of knives, I had to go to different knife trainers. So, but what, you know, at the beginning of the day, what I did was I thought, wouldn't it be great if we as Americans in America had a training system that prepared us in our country to protect ourselves, understanding law and physically how to use weapons, because we have weapons, we have guns, we have knives. Why would we not want to understand how to use these weapons right. to defend ourselves legally?
And one of the things, again, sorry not to interrupt, there's just so much stuff that I want people to know that I've heard that you even got into it. You had said on another show that you just wanted to be able to walk around and do whatever you want. And when I say do whatever you want, I don't mean anything bad, but you right. wanted to be safe. So right. you knew that, hey, if I learn martial arts, I learn, like, you know, even with a knife or a gun, but I'm sure at that time you were young where you probably weren't, you know, carrying a gun around, mm-hmm. but you could defend yourself. So you're like, hey, I don't want to be limited in where I can go, because if I go here, you know, I might get attacked, but right. I can defend myself, so I'm not worried about it.
Well, generally, I lived in the suburbs in a college town.
Right, in Ann Arbor.
And so I would be picked on by African-American kids, you know, thought I talked funny, or, you know, I had straight hair. Then I would be picked on by.
I heard you say you had hair like Prince at one point.
Yeah,
on
yeah.
a show.
So the Prince hair dude.
What was up with the Prince? Dude. Were you wearing purple shit too?
I would. If chicks liked it, I would definitely wear.
Did
purple.
You? How far did you go with the dress stuff? Did you get to like you've seen Dave Chappelle, right? Where he
right,
did the
right.
the shirts just, against the blouses.
I was just above actual apparel.
You didn't go to the blouses, live, right?
But I would do the hair only. I was like, right. hair only. Let's be clear. I'm glad you brought that up.
Because you weren't on the blouses team when you played.
No, no. I couldn't go. I had a Prince limit, and the limit was at the hair.
Right.
And so you know, so the violence was, you know, was minimal. You know, bullying, fighting. I grew up around.
When you got college mostly. Kids, too, and I don't know how, I mean, I know it was more of a safe place than where I grew up.
I don't know anybody who ever died. Ever.
But I'm sure, you know, same thing, like you might have ran into college kids at the mall or something, and maybe they fucked with you or picked on you.
Yeah, no,
or,
you know, it was mostly like, if there was an issue, it would be, you know, either, you know, because back then it was like jocks versus burnouts or
know,
preppy versus, you know, whatever.
What
rich kids, richies versus.
What year did you graduate, if you don't mind
high
me
school,
asking?
I graduated high school in 87 and I went to school in West Germany. So I graduated high school in West Germany.
Okay, and then for a year, I heard you went to, what, ninth grade military school?
Yes, yes. On ninth grade, I was actually at a military academy that's linked to the military, so you actually have
And it wasn't like, just to clarify so everybody knows, it wasn't like a military where you send bad people. It was like a military to learn stuff about the military.
Yeah, no, it's actually like a lot of kids would go there because they were forced to go because they're in trouble.
Oh.
I wanted to go there.
Oh, okay. So it was a school
kids
that went bad.
Or I could go to this school, which is like hardcore, man. They had helicopter training bivouacs with a ranger unit I was a part of in ninth grade. I was on a horseback riding brigade. We actually rode in horses in parades in ninth grade. I was on TV riding horses in a military parade. I was able to experience weapons training as well as precision drill training, where I was a competitor in precision drill, all in ninth grade, man. And what that has to do with like my life now is, even as a kid, I learned that having experience-based training makes people feel important and good, and it makes them feel accomplishment, and it makes them want to do more of the same. And so that's my thing with kids. Our kids program is based on experience-based training. So I like to get the kids lots of training so they feel like they're very empowered. They feel self-sufficient, self-reliant, not violent, but self-capable.
Right, right. And self-confident,
self-capable. Competence, but imagine it's competence-based confidence.
But I would think, you know, where you have the most people that can fight don't act like that. They act like nice people. And if something happens where they have to, they'll defend themselves. So I would think that stuff like that would cause you to be that type of person, because, you know, you can fight. You don't want to hurt people, and you don't need to prove yourself because you're confident that, hey, I can handle myself. So if something happens, I'll take care of it, but I'm not gonna, you know, act like a tough guy. Although you do have some people that can fight, unfortunately,
right? And that's also because when you're younger, man, that's why it's imperative not to teach kids a bunch of fighting. Because what happens is they you know, several things happen. One, you run the risk of creating a bully, especially if they were bullied.
Yeah, right? that's number what two, you don't want to do.
Right. Number two, the kid actually learns to answer violence or discomfort with violence. And number three, what's happening is you actually want to see what your techniques will do. That's called self-validation. You want to see if your skills actually work. And this happens to a lot of law enforcement officers who are young. Notice how 9 times out of 10, the problems you're having with officers, they tend to be very young. They tend to be in lower 20s. That's because it's called a rites of passage.
Well, there was psychology.
They want to become valid. That's all.
We had talked off air about that movie about the 175, and yes. That guy got hired at like 19 or 20. You know,
exactly.
he was a cop.
Problem. Right. That's too young. That's too young to have a sports car, let alone actually.
Yeah,
have a
yeah. Well, that was a guy who was driving a Corvette. To this was later. I think he was, you know, almost 30 by this time. But he was driving a Corvette to the fucking station on a cop's pay. And back then, he said he was making. He wasn't even picking up his checks because he was getting money from drug dealers. So he wasn't even picking up his checks driving a Corvette. I mean, you know it. It's crazy, but
right. And so what we got to do is we got to change our reality. Our whole understanding of human behavior has to change to reality based on experience and based on, you know, human compulsion, and not based on our own individual values and what we think of people. So typically in security work, for example, you know, I run into people all the time like, oh, security, it's great. It's great. Really? It's great. Security is great. Let's just think about that for a second. Who grows up to be a security guard? Do you understand how many bad decisions you have to make to become one? Do you know how many bad decisions you have to make as an adult in your life in a row to become a security officer?
Yeah,
so it's not something you grow up to become. So the concept that I'm going to have a like super security guard losers become great people is inappropriate thinking. No one wants to be a guard. No one wants to go to and by default, either you're really old, really young, or you're just not very smart, which is how you become a guard. And that's okay in that industry because you don't do anything anyway. Now, what we do in threat management is completely unrelated.
One thing I wanted to mention, because I talked about this before had called in, because I know that that's something that you talked about as well. And they happen to have security at my work, and I've talked to you off air about how they have that attitude. A lot of them, they want to be cops, or they're just, that's their only source of power in their life, where they couldn't do anything else. And now, hey, I'm a security guard, I can tell you what to do. And but yeah, it's like a loser type job. I mean, it is. And here, I mean, we have tons of security guards because of all the casinos. Now,
right.
I don't know. They probably do have some high level guys. But the majority of them, but I mean, at the top.
You're being nice.
No, but I mean, for casinos, because of the, at the top, like the guys that are watching the, that people that are counting cards and shit. But I'm talking about those guys. But the majority of them are riding bikes in the fucking garage. Like, I had some kid, he must have been like 19, told me I couldn't park somewhere because I'm an employee, and all of a sudden they got strict on it, and I had to park, up on the 9th fucking floor. But I had already got out of my car, and I'm like, if you weren't a fucking dick and you had actually customer service skills, you would have told me basically like, hey, they're cracking down. Because I was already out of my car, like walking,
And that's the point, man. That's the point.
They don't have to be
a bureaucratic asshole.
Exactly.
It's counterproductive for police and for security to act like that. It's counterproductive.
Because he instead of saying, because what he could have said is, look, it's fine for now, but can you, do me a favor and, park on that floor because they're cracking down on us and I, whatever. He could have been that type of person, but instead, he was a dick about it. And I was like, well, what are you going to do? Tow my car. And he's like, yeah, we can do that. And I was thinking in my head, like, I can rip you off that fucking bike right now. But not that I'm going to do that. But, so.
No, but that's what people don't
get. Left.
So I get really irritated. And I get offended when people try to accuse us of being that guy.
And right, right.
Do you think that guy can do what we do? I mean, I'm offended both ways. Like, I'm offended on the front end of that deal, and I'm offended on the back end of that deal. I'm offended when people call me a cop or when people call me
security guard. Yeah.
A security. It doesn't matter. Either one are both inappropriate. We train constantly. We don't disrespect people. We don't beat up people that aren't trying to attack us at the time. And even then, we take control of them without putting any marks on them.
Right.
We do not celebrate violence. I mean, all the things that represent law enforcement philosophy and methodology, I teach police officers against. And they're on my website testifying to how the techniques work for them, how happy these techniques made them as officers, and how appropriate they think these techniques are for police.
Yeah, and
so
I've seen
them.
Excuse
me, being them is very insulting, to say the least. Then to accuse me of being, or that we as an organization are private security police, double disrespect. Or if people understood that security guards kill more people than police probably every year, but there's no data because it's just right. called employees. Okay, they're not so cops get kind of like a hissy fit. They don't want people to say, okay, I think that these people are law enforcement related. They don't say that. They just call guards. Like so, there's no guard data. There's employee data, like you work at Walmart. So if you were to look up how many employees shot and killed patrons at the place of work, clearly not many people have guns at the place of
work.
Yeah,
I was going to say most of those people don't have, luckily.
They're not going to differentiate between the Walmart worker that had a gun and the Walmart security guard, the liquor store security guard, and the nightclub security guard, or the after-hours illegal security guard that was working there at the time he shot and killed Proof here in Detroit, the rapper. So there's no, there's not going to be any difference between any of those, as well as the probably the worker at McDonald's who shot someone, even though they weren't supposed to have a gun. So there's not going to be different data. So you don't know how many people are killed every year. I can just tell you one story. A Walmart security guard chased a woman and daughter into the woods, a mile into the woods. The next day, the woman and baby and a woman and her daughter both mysteriously ended up drowned in the river. He says he chased them and they lost him in the woods and must have fallen into the river. This dude clearly, and they were both beaten. Like they said, there's signs of struggle. So basically the security guard who sees women stealing this insured crap, right, that's of zero value because, by the way, 80% of all shrink is internal. So if you killed every single thief, which, by the way, the majority of shoplifters in America are, according to the data from those arrested, these are suburban white females at average age of 14, okay? So this concept that we're going to get these people who are stealing from the stores, that's who you're getting, okay? So if you want to shoot all the shoplifters, you're going to be shooting a bunch of suburban white girls that have money, by the way, at the time of their arrest to afford whatever they stole, okay? So we live this fantasy that's based on what they showed us on television and nefarious narratives. They're completely false, completely false.
Well, actually, with movies, there are a lot of movies about those, like, teenage girls stealing shit, actually.
Right, but not in our mind. In our mind.
Right, right.
Big black guy.
In my mind, that's what I think of, to be honest.
The big black guy.
I think of the teenage girls. But
The big black guy is going into the place and stealing stuff from the fucking mall. And by the way, that's not possible because the big black guy is being followed by all the employees.
Right. I used to actually, when I was in high school and I had braids in my hair and whatever, I used to always get... So, I get followed now. I don't know. It's more of a probably the way I come off and dress and shit, but yeah.
Well, you know what happens is we
follow it all the time.
Yeah, and so a lot of times, what happens is we have a perspective that's built on false narratives, either personal experiences, like you know, cow tipping. I don't fucking know about cow tipping. I never even saw a fucking cow get tipped. Okay, maybe it's a problem. And I heard some guy.
I don't know what the point of that is, but I guess they can't get up. Is the whole thing right?
They die or something, right? I don't give a shit. I never saw a cow get tipped. And so it's not relevant to me. So when someone talks about racism or religionism or anything else and you're not into that thing, it doesn't affect you, you really don't give a shit, you know? And so it's not an issue. So it becomes an issue, though, when it's relevant to your life, your quality of life. So when that security guard at your job decides he's going to tow your fucking car anyway, and then you come off from work and you're like, dude, I said I'd move the car. The guard said I could leave it here. He said, it's cool. And then he towed it anyway. He did it to be an asshole to you. And now your life's fucked up. You know, your car's gone. You got to figure out how to get the car. And I mean, all that shit. That is that now guards matter to you. Now the quality of guard. Now fucking guard rules and what can guards do or not do. And, you know, then becomes guards become relevant. Just like the
The fact that he made me fucking, you know, move because I wasn't going to take a chance. I was like, you know, fuck this.
Under threat. He had to fucking threaten you.
Yeah. I was like, well, I mean, I brought it up, but, I wanted to make sure, like, I don't want to, you know, when I come back, I want my fucking car to be here. Yeah, I mean, you know, yeah. So that's the first thing that came in my head. But I'm like, I'm already out the car, man. Really? You know,
Listen, what's fucked up is when you get the wannabe super cop or the off-duty cop, and now your life's fucked because now they're like, he just threatened me.
Yeah, like, and really all they are people they're there to call the police, really. I mean, that's like what they're there. I mean, if they didn't have the police to back them up, they're nothing.
And now security has security shit. The ability is very important to you. Make a threat, make, you know, you didn't even know that.
I think we lost Dale there. So let me.
Hello.
Yeah, I think we lost you. But...
Sorry about that. I'm by the river here in Detroit.
Actually, you sound better now.
Okay, good.
That's good.
So, but yeah, a lot of times people don't understand. Security guards kill people all the time.
I mean, the only difference between them and cops is they usually want to prove themselves even more. So, you know, the police officer has some belief that they have some inherent intrinsic value. The security guard wants to prove he has that value that the officer has.
Yeah, he doesn't have.
He's willing to kill you for that, okay?
But the good thing is most of them, they don't have, a few of them have guns, but most of them aren't armed, to be honest.
Yeah, well, it depends on where you go. And remember,
true, but
there's more guards than there are cops. Okay,
I know at least here they like Walmart does not have armed security.
Okay,
well,
no. Let's be clear about something, man. You mean they're not supposed to be armed? They are
true.
Actually,
they could be,
and they are. I've been a guard. I've been around guards. I used to work for guards.
You're right. They could be armed, and you don't know. But they're not open. Open carrying.
Yeah, they're not. So it means they're even less smart.
And open carrying is actually legal, but it's probably not work. I mean, it's illegal, but they don't want them. They tell them not to.
Liability, right. It's liability. That's all. It's just because the only difference between security and police is liability, okay? It's really.
Right.
You know what I mean? At the end of the
because,
day,
yeah,
like,
they'll get sued.
Why they don't have guns is based on liability.
Right.
99.99%, not the threat. So it could be fucking threatening as fuck on Monday, but on Tuesday, the insurance situation changed. You will not be carrying guns.
Right. Police liability, they don't give a fuck about because the taxpayers have to pay it.
Exactly. It has nothing to do with, like, the level of threat. And so, you know, I'm like a totally ridiculous. I mean, listen, not only are we the completely opposite of both security and law enforcement and philosophy and methodology, but also the actual objective, purpose, the system, every single thing. Like, we get paid up front. So security guard companies actually go 60 to 90 days net. Think about that for a second. So when you work for a security, for a typical security situation, the client knows they don't have to pay for 60 to 90 days.
Oh.
Think about how stupid that is. So you have to pay all your employees for 60 to 90 days working at this site, whatever it is, church, parking lot, or a fucking mall.
Right.
And then they pay you 60 to 90 days later.
That's crazy.
So other companies have come along and started loaning security guard companies money, of course, at a profit. So
yeah.
They'll give you your, you know, $50,000 loaned for your payroll for the month, but you're going to have to give them $55,000.
Interest, right.
Right, $5,000 interest. So, you know, that's a huge industry, a billion-dollar industry is just loaning fucking guard companies money.
That's crazy. I mean, well, it's kind of like the bail bonds industry here where it's totally fucking corrupt. It's not corrupt, but it's a scam. It's a total scam with the government and the fucking bail bondsmen. But I know I threw you totally off track there as far as going into what your company does that's totally different from anybody else. And I do always mention that when I talk about security and like what exists now, and when I mention your company, that I like there to be whatever you want to call it. Sometimes I'll call it security, but over police, because of course police will arrest you and we know how that all goes, but not the type of security guards that exist today. The type of threat management that you provide is what should really exist, because the current security guard model is just, it's not as bad as police because they don't really have any power. And like you said, because of the liability, they don't give them much power and they're just kind of annoying, really.
No, dude, no, man, I swear to you,
but
I promise you, it's completely worse in every way. These guys, although they can't pull you over, they'll do it anyway. Although they're not supposed to.
Oh, I'll never pull over for a security guard.
Oh, you won't know a security guard. You won't know. And then they'll pull you out of cars, beat the shit out of you. It happens all the time.
Really?
And what happens remember, bouncers are security guards. Okay?
I'll fucking, because if a security guard tries some shit like that on me, they're going to get shot.
Yeah, I mean, that happens too.
I'm not kidding.
Guards are in shootouts. Guards are in shootouts all the time. If you know how many guards got killed, way more guards get killed in America than police officers. Way more.
Police officers, you know, in 2011, and this was the lowest year, 37 got killed. It's because I know you mentioned on a show 100. It's way under 100. It's way under 100, though.
A lot of the cases of them, they'll say they died on the job or were shot in the job.
Yeah, they're in car accidents and suicides.
Some of them are suicides, right. The car accidents are considered car accidents, but some of the actual shootings are actual suicides.
Right, right.
So...
Well, the on the job, I guess you can commit suicide on the job, but yeah, the actual shootings, I mean, are they average between? Because I looked at the numbers, I know 2007 was the lowest, and it was 37, and we're talking about the whole fucking country, and like eight of them were. I remember one year looking at it, were in Puerto Rico, which is part of the country, but. It looks like the highest when it comes to police getting shot, and it's still not that many. I mean, not many policemen get killed by people, basically.
That's right.
And when they do, especially
police officers, most cops don't know. And you know what else? Most cops are surprised when I tell them that the leading cause of death for cops is suicide. Most cops do not know that the vast majority of police officers die from suicide.
Right, they kill themselves. And then I think second would probably be, car accidents. I know it was up there.
It's car accidents. And then it's, actual criminals.
But that's lower.
It's a very safe job. You know, it's not even one of the top 10 unsafe
dangerous jobs. Possessions. Possessions of jobs, right. It's not even top 15. It's not even top 15 because they rarely get killed. And like I said, when they do, it's usually because a lot of times I read about like this cop who didn't turn on his fucking sirens, but maybe he forgot and he's going 120 and he fucking gets in a car accident and a Las Vegas cop and dies. I'm like, you fucking idiot. So, I mean... some of them are, even dying in car accidents where you ever see, this is movies, but I know they do this shit too, where they're trying to get home and they turn on their fucking lights or something like that.
Drag race. They're just people, man.
Yeah,
cops are just people, okay? What happens when you give a guy a fast car and then you give him the right to go fast and not get pulled over? Well, nothing good. And so, at the end of the day, we're looking at them like they're some kind of alien. They're just people. Police are just people. If you gave your buddy a very fast car and authority to go as fast as he wants without getting a ticket, your buddy would be going very fast.
Speaking of that, just real quick, I don't know. You might have heard of the incident in Miami a couple years ago where there was a woman There was a guy who was speeding to work every day. He was a cop, but he was going to another job. So he's going like 120 or something like that. And she actually gave him a ticket. So he's like, you can't fucking, I'm a cop. You can't give me a ticket, basically. So she was harassed by the whole fucking department because maybe she was a state and he was Miami police or something like that. They were in different departments.
Yeah, she wasn't state. They do this a lot.
It might have been different. It was different departments. They weren't in the same department.
This is the secret, man. There's a big, huge race, religious problem in law enforcement. There's no blue code. It's not really real. So a lot of the cops hate each other, first of all. And a lot of the each department kind of competes for position of bragging rights, and so, and all of them have one collective decision. They hate the inner city, especially African-American cops.
Well,
Mexican cops, they hate them.
Well, yeah, she was Latino, but
she's not Latino, and there's different kinds of Latinos.
I think she was Puerto Rican, actually.
You got the Mexican Latinos, okay?
I think she was Puerto Rican, but I know
so
that
then you got Puerto Ricans and you got white.
It wasn't
people, so it's really about it's more about how they look, white or not.
But it wasn't the first time this had happened over and over again, and then finally she gave him a ticket.
The white suburban departments. I don't care what state you're in; it's the same in every state. The white suburban departments do not like the black urban except the guys that are white guys are going to transfer out to the suburbs from the city officers. And the inner city officers have problems every day. I just talked to an officer today who was arrested. He's retired, right? Just retired. And he was arrested by one of the suburban departments who focuses on fucking with Detroit cops. Okay. They literally looked for Detroit cops to pull over. He was pulled over walking out of a gas station. He wasn't even in his car. Then he was told to stop fucking singing. This is a cop now telling, this is a like a suburban redneck cop right on the outskirts of Detroit. It's very, very fucking racist here. And around all major cities like this. But anyway, so he pulls his black cop over while walking, okay, at a gas station. He says to him, shut your fucking mouth. He says, who are you talking to like that? And he says, you know what? Come here. So he goes over there and he says, what? He goes, I'm a retired officer. What's going on? And he goes, and I'm carrying my guns to let you know. All of a sudden, all hell breaks loose. The suburban officer jumps up, calls for backup. Six cars pull up. Anyway, they verify his weapon, verify he's a police officer, blah, blah, blah. They charge him with disorderly conduct and some other shit. And he plea bargains down for a misdemeanor. I mean, almost ruined his fucking life. And
that's crazy.
So he talks to some other cops, you know, and they're like, what is the deal, man? We don't fuck with these cops when they come to our city. Why are they doing it? And they said, well, basically all Detroit cops get fucked with in this particular suburb. And it's the same in all the suburbs. So
well, what they did with this girl, though, is the whole department came after her, harassing her. They left stuff at her house. And she ended up filing a lawsuit because she was harassed by like the whole department that the cop she pulled over worked for.
That's normal.
And it was fucked up.
That's normal. That's normal. But she also probably got harassed by. There's two, not just the outside of her department. There's no real blue code, man. A lot of times, the women that are female officers are abused severely and significantly by male officers. There's lots of problems, man. It's a huge.
Yeah, I mean, I know you had mentioned that before.
The problems they have. It's unbelievable. It literally is unbelievable. You know what? If people knew how many problems law enforcement officers and departments have, they would literally feel sorry for them, and they would immediately.
I'm not feeling sorry for them.
Oh God,
no matter what, man. It's,
I promise you, you would change your whole life. How would you? You know what you would say? How do they even have time for us out here? That's how many lawsuits and problems they have within each department for everything you could think of and 10 things you never thought were possible. And so I say that to say that there's lots of problems there, man. And you really would be surprised. Like every time I see these videos of harassment, I'm like, what? I mean, you have so many other issues to deal with, right?
Yeah.
And I really don't understand why you're even, even going on this path. But you know, what's funny is I saw a lot of violent criminals talk to cops and talk their way out of every fucking thing. I know of one guy, he talked himself out of a jail cell. And he's a murderer. And they caught him. And he yelled and screamed so loud, they let his ass out. He was locked up in a precinct, right? And they were running his fingerprints, and they're waiting for them to come out, right? The fingerprints to come back. And for whatever reason, it was a glitch or something, it wasn't coming back, and they were going to hold him because they just felt like he was up to something, right? And this guy is a murderer, let's be clear. And he is wanted for murder, and they have him in the cell. He screams so much like, oh, this is a setup, this is all wrong. They actually let him go in the morning, and they found out in the afternoon that he really was him, that he really was the murderer they thought he was. I only know this story because I know him, and I know his sister. And his sister came and told me the story. But I already knew he was a bad guy. He's just an actual real bad guy. And so I say that to say that the real bad guys, they know how to, and I've seen it personally standing right there,
A lot of times people don't understand this. They know how to talk to police officers, and they know how to emotionally connect with them, and they do not argue with them 99.9% of the time. The most violent, vile, horrific criminals do not argue with police, ever. Police officers can actually hit them, and they'll say, "I'm sorry, sir." And you're like, wait a minute, you're a bad guy. The bad guys never play that game. And guess what? A lot of times the cops let them go. It's unbelievable. Or reduce their charges. It's unbelievable. And then you got this other person didn't do anything. They have an attitude because they feel offended that the police are even having contact with them, unwanted contact.
Yeah, and I wanted to talk to you about that later as well. Mm-hmm. But I know I keep fucking interrupting getting to... It just so much stuff to talk about, but yeah. So I'm sorry. Continue with what you guys do and how okay. you're different from regular security, and I'll shut up.
So basically, in a nutshell, we're a school first, community service second. So we help keep people alive and safe, and then third, I had to find a way to actually pay for my schools and pay for. My ability to help people. So I wanted to recruit people, get them paid so they can actually be consistent. So I created an organization that makes rich people richer as a byproduct of helping regular people. So, you know, to be clear, the business is a byproduct of the purpose, not the reverse. And a lot of times on the internet, on Facebook and other places, we're getting a lot of respect for what we do, but what they're doing is they're reversing it. They're saying, look, these people that are security, that are security professionals, that are profiting greatly, making money, what they're doing is they're actually helping people for free, and they actually have a school. It's the exact opposite. It's only because I have a school that we know what to do, and I can train people and inculcate them in a positive training system so they're not out rape, robbing. I have a special island I get people from. What it is, I create a condition psychologically that changes their feeling of purpose. And then I have a management system so that I can detect when they have nefarious intent and when they plan to deviate before they have a chance to go and do something illegal or immoral to someone. So it's a management system, an entire redundant, transparent system based on performance, not based on seniority or nepotism or cronyism, which is the key to law enforcement longevity. Who you know, who knows you, who you're related to, who likes you, that's what determines. The best cops in America were probably fired by the shittiest cops who are now in charge. And that'll always be the case because the system, not because there's a secret government agenda, is because if I'm a bad cop, meaning I don't do good things or I don't give a shit, I'm not going to let some superhero cop come up the ranks and take my position and fire me one day. I'm going to fire his ass before he even gets in here. And so you can't take, and this is a standard rule in corporate America, you can't ask a loser to hire and train a winner. And that's an inherent fatal flaw within the law enforcement industry, is that they're actually asking police officers to pick the new ones. How could a police officer pick a new one that's going to outperform them and make them look bad, and possibly fire them one day?
Right. They don't want somebody who's better
right.
than so they are the that's going to take their position.
Exactly. So I did the opposite of my system. My system, it doesn't matter what you say about them. What matters is their actual ability to prove themselves based on their actual testing. And so we have tests on a weekly basis that determine your position, your pay rate, everything is based on your ability, not based on how old you are. If you got old, somehow you get more money. and so, in fact, you get old, you might have to just not deploy at all in protective service and just become an educator, which pays 10 times as much anyway. So the highest amount we've ever made for, say, protecting someone, the highest amount paid for teaching is $1,500 an hour. So you can't compare the $2 amounts, nor should you. Education is a lot more valuable than facilitation.
You went out on the first one.
Education is more important and more lucrative.
No, when you talked about the amount on the first part.
The fact that, 1,500, the highest amount we've ever made while protecting someone is $150 per hour.
Okay, yeah, that's where it went out.
Yep. And the highest amount paid that we've ever made for teaching is $1,500 for 1 hour. So the teaching aspect, the education, pays at 10 times the rate of facilitation.
So that's what really supports the business the most is the teaching.
Actually, no. It's right now it's facilitation, but it's going to be transitioning to education. So we're opening other training facilities, and we're also going to have the ability for people to volunteer, and we're also going to still have the ability to link with local security firms in hopes of creating conditions where we can have paid services for people in those different communities through a DECA program through a local corporation in that area and doing collaborative efforts that way. Or just having volunteers in your particular area that can help for different situations of actual imminent threat. But people that are trained. Without training, people going to a situation of threat is very insane. So imagine if you don't know how to hunt bears, and I just say to you, hey, meet me out back. There's a bear back here. Bring your gun. What gun? What kind of load do you bring? I mean, do you know anything about
what kind of round or gun do you need to take down?
Where do you
bear?
Shoot the bear? Right. Where do you shoot the bear? Shit. The bear is in the insane. It's literally insane. You don't wait. What if I told you don't even know how many bears are back? You just know it's a bunch of them, or it could be one. We're not sure, but they're killing people. We need to go over there. Come on. I'm gonna send a call out to you so you can come help me deal with the bear back here in the woods. That is insane. And 99.99% of the people will never go to help you deal with some bear in the backyard unless they have experience dealing with a bear. And that's the reason, because it's smart. You don't do that. Humans are the apex predator on this planet. They hunt bears for fun. So to think that you would just go out in your backyard or go on over to your neighbor's backyard or down the street and go take them on, and you don't know how many they are, what kind of weapons they have, is literally insane. And so one of the things that I try to get across people is that you wouldn't ask someone to do a surgery for you. Like, hey, you know, you're my buddy. I like you. And could you just do a little surgery on my arm here? I'd like you to cut it off for me. Well, guess what? Managing human threat is way harder than surgery. Way, way harder. You can actually go into a situation meaning well and shoot someone's child by accident. You can mean well and shoot through the criminal and kill your own child. I mean, it's just literally ridiculous the number of things that go wrong, but I guarantee you it would be easier to be a surgeon than an actual human being that can manage human threats properly. It's very, very complex. You will need to qualify for immunity if you're going to manage human threat. It's very difficult. You're going to shoot the wrong person. You're going to shoot kids. You're going to get angry, and you're going to respond to people who are threatening you. And that's what humans do. Humans threaten other humans. You're going to get mad. You're going to get scared, and you're going to respond. And during that response, it's not going to necessarily be measured or appropriate based on the level of threat. You're going to respond based on your emotional condition. And unless you have a lot of training. Police do not have a lot of training. So when you anger them, they're prone to respond. When you shoot at them, they're prone to shoot back regardless of the field of fire being clear or not. When they, and it may not be you shooting, it could be someone else shooting. They still think it's you and they'll shoot anyway. Because without understanding proper target acquisition, your brain will play tricks on you, and then you think that person's shooting when it's really not even them. So a lot of training goes into managing human threat, and that's the other thing I want to get across to people is that the reason for Threat Management Center is to help people not make these false positives, to have alternative options. And I don't know if you just heard about Zimmerman. Did you just hear about he was in a bar and got punched?
Yeah,
911.
Heard something happened.
Yeah,
there.
And these were bikers that were armed, and they called him a nigger lover, and then they threatened to kill him, and they punched him in the face, and they threatened him, and he had his gun, but he forgot to draw it. The police told him not to engage and not to go out and follow him, so he didn't. So basically, he can only shoot and draw his gun and follow threatening people if they're unarmed African-American kids. Because as soon as it's a white guy who clearly said, fuck you, and punched you in your face and says, come outside and I'll fucking kill you,
you just can't go out there, which doesn't make sense. If you're Zimmerman and you stand, you know, you're about safety and you got your gun, go on out there. But the truth was, the only reason he killed Trayvon is because he could. It's because it's easy.
In his defense, if he does anything now, he's a target as it is, as far as he's going to be crucified.
Oh, no, man. He just did some other shit. Remember, he beat up the girl.
Well, they say, I don't know. But
he's an asshole. Dude, anybody who shoots a fucking unarmed kid is a bitch. And anybody who doesn't fucking shoot a biker who punches him in the mouth and threatens to kill him is a bitch.
That's true.
Somebody comes beat your ass and says, I'll fucking kill you. It's probably pretty much time to defend yourself. If you refuse to defend yourself, you're pretty much a fucked up individual. And you definitely shouldn't be carrying a gun or talking shit and shooting kids. But what you'll find is that many people are able to shoot unarmed children that fail to engage.
So, as far as I know,
growing daily, able to drive up, run up, shoot unarmed kids. But then when it's time to shoot a man with a gun, very, very difficult for them to do that. And I think that, I mean, I understand why. I'm not just an educator. I'm a person who's put boots on the ground and blood in my hands dealing with violent people. So I can tell you why men are cowards and why they do these things and why they can kill unarmed people. Because they're cowards. And then the way you know is when it's clearly obvious that there's a threat, you'll see these same assholes that found it necessary to hit a girl, hit a fucking kid, pull out their gun and point at people. When it's time to fucking shoot, they can't shoot. I've been through many shootouts, and you see these guys that they were pointing their gun on Monday, pointing their gun, right? And then it's fucking time to shoot on Saturday, and they can't shoot.
Yeah, you can't. I mean, the rule with that is if you draw a gun, you got to be prepared to shoot it. It doesn't mean you have to shoot it because you may not have to. Hopefully,
dude, 9 out of 10 people pull guns on people are 9 out of 10 people pull guns on people are just posturing. Okay,
so no, that's why. No, but yeah, you. I mean, if you pull a gun, you should be prepared to shoot it. Otherwise, you shouldn't pull it. But
I know there are many people that do that. You mean that's a civilian rule? Because police, that is not the case. They pull out their guns 99.99% of the time. They will never shoot their gun.
Police. See, when I look at civilians compared to police is a totally different thing, because you're talking about the government. You're talking about people that's their job, that they're supposedly trained to handle these situations.
Dude. Actually, I'm so. That's not true. The actual fucking people pull their guns way more than cops do.
No, but I don't fault people for that, because when it comes to civilians compared to the government, it's a totally different thing to me. It's just like when they'll bring up,
Hello.
You having problems hearing me? Or?
Yeah, I got you now.
Okay. So it, just like when people will bring up, they'll compare, why are you protesting people getting killed by the police, but you're not protesting, black-on-black crime? Well, it's a totally different thing. You're talking about the government killing people as opposed to individuals killing each other. So...
But let's be clear, those are not individuals, those are called criminals.
Well,
if a criminal does a crime, that's not just an individual.
They're not killing each other in self-defense. Well, technically, yeah. I guess they could be, but yeah, most of them are, there's a lot of gangbangers and shit like that are just shooting each other.
The majority of our shootings have nothing to do with gangs at all. Most of our shootings in our country are fucking people that don't like other people or having a problem or misunderstanding, and they have a fucking gun. It has nothing to do with gangs. Gang members do not fucking shoot each other, because when they do, that leads you to getting fucking shot back. They shoot women, children, old people, and people they're robbing and fucking over. See, what happens is we have this fantasy that was shared with us through television, through these media movies, and people accentuate them. And they're like, that's like thinking gangbangers should fight. You ever seen a gangbanger fight?
No, they can't shoot. They don't practice shooting.
But they'll talk shit about it. And then the cops are like, oh, they you know, they're fucking shootout gangs.
Well, that's why you have so many, you know, people that get hit by stray bullets, because most of these kids are criminals or whatever you want to call them. They get a gun. They never fucking learned anything about it.
Okay.
And they do drive-bys and fucking can't hit anybody.
Okay,
or can't hit the person they're trying to hit. They hit some four-year-old riding her bike. It's fucked up.
How about
up.
The police? They fired 81 rounds at one guy.
Well, in New York?
81 rounds, yeah. And they hit
everybody but that person, yeah.
No, they shot 81 rounds at one guy who stole a car.
Oh, you're talking about something different, okay.
Yeah, he shot back at them, and his gun ran out of bullets. And then they shot him in the leg. One out of 81 rounds hit him in the leg, okay? One out of 81.
Then they missed every I guess they can't shoot neither.
No, they can't. That was Amadou Diallo 15 years ago, 20 years ago. He was shot 41 rounds at 6 feet. Okay. They were 6 to 8 feet away from him. They shot 41 rounds. 12 of the 41 rounds hit him, and they were like 6 to 8 feet away from him at the time. Okay. So when you think about that the averages, it's very difficult to shoot under stress and duress. So when your heart rate increases, you're scared, it's just very fucking hard.
Well, it's hard to, you know, especially if somebody's moving. I mean, I've shot, you know, I've got a bunch of different guns, and, you know, it's hard enough to hit a target that's standing still.
Right.
Never mind, you know, try running and hitting it.
Unarmed African-American kids are easy to shoot. They're very easy. Tamir Rice was just standing there. Officer just drove up.
Yeah,
he thought he had a gun in his waist or something, and he said he shot him. Well, I mean, if you took that same officer and took him to Dallas, he should be able to do the same thing. You just drive up to the guy and just shoot him, right? Bullshit. You would never do that, and no cop would ever drive up to a person with a gun that they thought was an actual gun. No cop would ever do that unless he's fucking insane, would drive his police car up.
Yeah, they did. They drove, right, yeah.
Total bullshit.
And then you have...
Ferguson, Mike Brown. Oh, I think he's a criminal. Really? So what did you do? Oh, I drove my patrol car right up next to him and told him to stop jaywalking. But I knew he was a criminal who stole.
Well, he didn't know that at that point. That's what happened beforehand. That's bullshit.
Well, that didn't even happen, dude. That none of that shit's true. And if you understand timelines, and that's why they don't share timelines, you'd see that even that shit wasn't true. But here's what you know is true. If a 300-pound person gets inside of a car with a police officer, nobody's going to be able to do shit.
And that
police officer did get attacked somehow, and let's just go with Wilson's dumbass story. So let's go with his story. So you get out of a car and the perp kid takes off running. Now there's a criminal right next to him, which is with him when he attacked you to kill you with your gun. You know, you said Wilson said that he was coming to kill him. Okay, fine. So you got two guys standing there. Are you trying to tell me you don't hold the other guy accountable? So you're like a super right. nice person. If two men come to you and one tries to kill you, the other one is okay unless he tries to separately. Really? So you shoot at the one person, but you don't shoot at the one standing next to you? How does that make sense?
Well, cops are trained liars, so.
Well, here's what you know. Even when you lie, you can't lie about the facts of the reality of the situation. So all you got to do is think to yourself, would anyone let two men attack them? Well, two men, and one attacks them of the two men, and you let the other one stand there while you get out and engage the other one. No one would do that. You would assume both men are your attackers. Unless you know for sure the second guy's not attacking you. For sure. Now, think about how what someone would have to do to convince you that one guy's trying to kill you. They're both two friends walking together. One tries to kill you, but you're so sure the other guy's not trying to kill you that you let him stand next to you while you shoot his friend. That's pretty trusting.
Yeah.
It's fucking ridiculously ignorant. And so what happens is the layout of the stories, and every police officer knows that you never approach a criminal, okay? He says the guy fit his description, even if he was just jaywalking.
No, but he didn't know even if whatever, you know, because they kept changing the story, that when they drove, he drove down the street, all he was, they were guilty of, if you want to call him guilty of something, was walking in the street. at that point. And that's all he was aware of. And, you know, but to me, and I did a show on this, I mean, the media, there's so many stories. I mean, there's about four people that are killed a day by police. And to cover one that got the most attention, but there were ones that were a lot more blatant, where
way more than four, man. Listen, if you just do the math,
at minimum is four.
It's way higher. It's ridiculous. The number of the actual number of deaths would be so ridiculous that it would undermine our reality of how we live in our country. It's that pervasive, and quite honestly, most of it's not nefarious. It's just part of the training mechanism. The training. So if you've ever been on like a sports team or something and been a part of a team doing anything dumb, you'll see that humans, they follow, you know, we're followers. And so, you know, that's where we run into issues. If we could just teach people to be individuals, and make individual decisions, we'll find that, you know, they'll make a lot better, decisions. But when we have groupthink, it usually turns out very badly. You know, you got college kids that kill other college kids every year in hazing events.
Right.
Those are evil kids. They're just, you know, hey, those are good Christian kids that come from a good two-parent household, and suddenly they're killing another child, whether it's bong in the ass or, you know, hitting them with something or drinking too much to death or whatever the method is. The bottom line is...
Well, when you're doing that, your intention is not to kill them. When you're shooting at somebody, your intention is to kill somebody.
Well, 9 times out of 10, man, quite honestly, it's not. They, you know, these killings, these shootings are usually an expression. That's why you always hear about the story of them like shooting like this random kid that's not involved, or, you know, random lady down the street. And that's because they're shooting as an expression. If they're not, I'll give you an example. Like in one of our communities, a guy shoots a house, right, 32 times, right, with two handguns. He shoots 32 rounds. That's as near as we can tell from the bullets, right? So how come not any glass is broken, okay? And no people, and the house is filled with like 8 people. Nobody shot, and not even one piece of glass is broken, and a house is really big with glass everywhere. Because the kid was kid in his 20s was trying to make a point, and the point was he didn't want to kill anybody. What he wanted to do was create terror, and he felt like he had been offended by this girl and he wanted to teach her a lesson. And really was about his boys who were teasing him about something. Okay. And so what we see and what we hear from television is this giant nefarious plan of, you know, diabolical nature. Listen, anytime that the criminals want to be diabolical and violent, they can. There's nothing that stops them from saying, I would like to go to this church. I would like to go to this police station. I like to go to this college and do a horrible thing. They just don't. Now ask yourself, why are the gangs not going to churches? Why are the gangs not going to schools, colleges? Why are the gangs not going to police stations? Why are the gangs not going to sporting events? Why are the gangs not hijacking aircraft? I mean, why? They know they could do that and get money and kill people and create carnage. How come they don't do any of those things? And all those things have been done by like college graduates with two parent households. How come there's a fascination with, a gangster, especially a drug dealer, which I think is hilarious. A person who sells something to someone is this horribly, you know, violent person. He could just go take things from someone. He doesn't need to sell anything. If he's violent, that's how he would do it. But our mindset, man, has been so programmed.
I think we lost you there.
Really, really, most drug dealers have nothing to do with violence because that's not profitable. Now, thug dealers, that's different. That's people that want to make money to create violent conditions. But that's secondary.
Right, and that's a cause of the government. But that's the reality is... All these drug cartels and all these big violent drug dealers is is a small, tiny percentage. The majority of people that sell drugs are not even violent. However, they still they justify, you know, SWAT teaming somebody in the middle of the night and kicking the door in because, you know, that's what they want to do. The SWAT team raids have gone up, way up in, you know, the past 20 years, especially I think the past 10. Radley Balco from the Rise of the Warrior Cop, he had all the stats in there. But, you know, the no-knock raids and the we got to get the drugs. But the other thing is that, you know, to me, there's still this mentality of you have to obey me. And if you don't,
okay, let's start there, man. Let me say
the comply or die mentality, right. And okay, and it's now, happened a lot of times, and I can name a bunch of examples.
Let me be clear, man. This has nothing to do with police, though. This is basic human psychology. So when you go to a drive-thru at McDonald's and you go to get your order, and the lady says to you or the guy says to you, "Hold on, I'll be with you in a minute," and you're like, "Okay, I was ready to do my order," and also like, "I said, hold on." Now, there's nothing going on in there that's so important that they need to be fucking yelling at you and having you wait and all that shit. It's a power move. It's about power and control. It turns out psychologically, humans are always trying to reach boundaries, unless, of course, they have some kind of discipline or structure, to see how much power and control.
You went out for a minute there, I think.
Feel the most vulnerable. These people are the ones that want to express some type of control and power over others the most to get back some feeling of control in their own life. So when a person is, like, for example, rape victims will become ultra-violent towards, you know, males, or, you know, just resentful because they have been violated. Right. People that have been abused, bullies. People have been bullied become bullies quite often when they can reverse the situation. You know, so some of the worst people that ever work in aid agencies are people that needed aid before. You know what I mean? Like, if they were starving when they were kids, they're not a good person to, you know, work in a restaurant or work in aid agencies because they're so hyper vehemently against whatever this is that they become imbalanced or unbalanced about a subject matter. So I know, like, a cop whose sister was beaten to death by a domestic violence guy. Anytime he goes to a situation involving domestic violence, he fucking loses it. And attacks the
and
guy,
he shouldn't
right?
be a cop. But that's
he's that, not a cop. He's not a cop now. He's been fired.
Good.
He's like a good Christian guy. Doesn't cuss. Goes to Christian church 5 days a week. You know, in the choir. I cuss all the time. Never go to church. And I, you know, I don't have the problem. He has the problem where he feels he needs to attack these guys who attack women. And so my point in saying that is we're saying that, and this is where we get it confused. We as a society have to respect psychology. And so why do certain cops feel the need to do that? It's the same reason any other people feel the need to abuse others.
Right, but you're still, you know, if you work at McDonald's and you do that, you're not killing somebody. And that's where I understand what you're saying, where it's just a natural human response, or and it's a natural human
Well, the number one killer, the number one killer of children is what? What's the number one killer of kids?
I think they're parents.
That's correct. Why is that? Power and control. Not conscious. Not sitting around going, "I would like to kill my child today." This is usually something along the lines of, you know, you'll see that if you look deeper into situations, they feel a sense of helplessness, and, you know, somewhere, you know, postpartum syndrome.
Yeah, and they
drug related. So
people lose it.
They lose it.
There's a number of reasons.
Yeah, there's
but,
a number
yeah.
of contributing factors, but the parents are the key. So
right.
people with contact and control and power to do this.
Well, parenting, the way people parent is really fucked up. And I've done shows on this as well.
Yeah.
And there's peaceful parenting where there's also, I mean, you bring your kid up to obey most people, to obey them and tell them, "Hey, you know, do this because I said so." And then you expect them, you know, or you don't expect them, but what do you think you're going to get when they turn 18? And then basically the government becomes their parent. And now you have people that essentially don't think for themselves and now have the government as their parent because they've been brought up in a way that they just obey. People are trained to obey.
Well, I mean,
from an early age.
Right, right, of course. But we're like, for example, we're African American. I'm African American, so we're part of slave culture. So our whole concept is based upon beatings. So you know, the African American household is really based upon what we were taught in slavery, which is training is done through the whip. So we are whipped and beaten. You know, and so what's so funny is you'll hear these people say things like, people need spankings, they need to get whipped. Really, go talk to prisoners, see if they got any spared whippings. Most of those guys are victims of extreme domestic violence.
Well, I would get punched in the face, but that doesn't mean that, you know, because that was the type of culture that my father and his father and they came from, that, you know, that side of the family was all Jewish and whatever. They had that mentality and it, that was passed down, and that's what it was, you know. And my father was a very angry person and whatever, that doesn't mean it's okay no matter what the.
No, but it doesn't mean it's okay, but it's what you're going to do unless you just.
Right. But people need to change that. And that's where somebody along the line needs to change that. And I think working towards freedom, you know, one of the most important things I think, besides, you know, the issue with the police and the drug war, is parenting and getting parents to recognize that the concept of self-ownership and that their kids are not their property. No matter how much they believe that this is my kid, they, you know, I own them, and, you know, they're going to do whatever I say, especially at a teenage, you know, it's different when they're younger, but still, there's a difference between just like your mentality. It's almost similar in a way. When you take your mentality of explaining kind of something to somebody, or not even explaining, but your approach to somebody compared to a cop's approach, right, and a parent that is an authoritarian that's like, you're going to do whatever the fuck I tell you, compared to a parent that's like, hey, you know, you shouldn't do this because if you do, you know, this is going to happen. You know, you don't put your hand on a hot stove because you're going to hurt yourself. Not don't do that because I fucking told you not to.
Right. Well, you know what this is going to lead to anyway. When you just tell people to do things, they have to, you know, they have to understand why. If you even hope for them to listen.
Yeah.
So it's inherent that people are not going to listen unless they personally understand the reasons.
But we're getting into, and this kind of leads into a question about your company as well, about change, but we're getting into, first of all, where more the people that are having the most kids are the poorest and most uneducated, first of all, and we're building a society of obedience where there is going to be no freedom, period, because they're raising their kids. Even people that are affluent as well are doing it.
Hold on. Can you go back to the – I couldn't hear what you said before.
Oh, sorry. Well, I said one of the things is that and affluent people treat their kids badly as well. I'm not saying it's just poor people. But the majority of people that – more kids are coming from – lower income people are having more kids than more affluent, intelligent, you know, successful people.
What's that? I'm sorry. What's the correlation?
Well, it's not necessarily that those kids, I mean, first of all, those kids, it doesn't mean that those parents will follow the, you know, just do what I say thing, because like I said, you know, affluent parents can be the same way. They can actually be worse. But part of it,
my experience there's been that poor parents tend to be preoccupied with other things than other than control.
Well, they don't really parent, but that's another issue. But
right.
But that leads to, like, I don't know if you saw that that movie where with Luke Wilson, Idiocracy, where it's like a stupid society 500 years later because all the ignorant people had all the kids and all the smart people didn't. But that's a whole nother issue. But see,
this is part of our issue, man, is that we are falling prey to nefarious narratives that are false. So, for example, you've never heard of a poor kid ever. A poor kid has never gone and committed a mass killing for the purpose of mass killing. You know what I mean? Like, to get the record, those are all, you know.
Oh, I'm not saying
all
that.
All the bombers are basically Christian, idealists. That, you know, so.
But those are small percentages anyway, and I'm not saying that.
No, they're actually larger.
Smarter of the population, they're small percentages, is what I mean of when things like that happen. But like shootings, like school shootings are a tiny percentage of the population, of the percentage of population. But what I'm saying is actually has nothing to do with that part because, you know, like I said, whether you're poor or not, you can still be an asshole parent. But I'm saying is for anybody, what the majority of people, rich or poor or whatever, are raising their kids to essentially grow up to be slaves of the system and not question things and not think for themselves. And they're bringing them up in a way where it's just obey, do what I tell you and obey me and not teaching to think for themselves. Schools don't do that. I don't believe in government schools, period. Schools definitely don't do that. You know, so people are they're getting passed off from their parents to the government and basically becoming ignorant, you know, slaves of the system. Mm-hmm. One of the questions that kind of relates to it, but not really, it relates to the change factor. So I know you've had a lot of police that have come that you've trained. So how do you get them? And some of them have been unsuccessful and you weren't able to change them, but some of them you were. The ones that you were, how are you able to change their mentality from the cop mentality to what you practice? Or were they already open to stuff like that? Did you ever take somebody who you thought, like, you know, this is a lost cause?
So once you get someone to think differently, once you get them to believe differently, once you get their brain to click and see things differently, then they begin to behave differently, even though they subconsciously were affected and did not consciously want to change.
Right.
And so I'll get officers come back that last time I talked to them, you know, were very non-receptive. And then they come back with, you know, a great story of how they used something I taught them or something I exposed them to.
So is that, interrupt.
Quite often it's not purposeful. So a lot of some of the most profound, you know, police stories I have were not from people that were actually consciously aware that they were changed by something I said.
It had to be through experience. It was through experience that they realized by something happening.
Yes.
That, yes. Okay.
Yeah, and they evolved. They literally said, you know what, let me try this. And a lot of times it'll be like a little half-ass kind of thing. Like, well, he said this, let's see that stupid shit if it works. And they'll try it. And then they're like, oh my God, I can't believe how well it worked. And, you know, or they'll say it clicked on them. Like it just clicked at the right moment. You know, a really positive thing happened. And that civilians have the same. I have the same. I know I have more stories from civilians about that, about how they use our. It's really about how I created something called tactical psychology, and so it's about how we use our understanding of psychology to achieve objectives. So once you understand how humans think, and you use inspiration and persuasion rather than intimidation and force and threat of violence. You don't have to do that. You can actually get people to see things a certain way, and they want what you want, as long as you can have the intellect, the ingenuity, and the initiative
to be able to describe that to them.
But what tools do you use, I guess, to, you know, when you're trying to change that mentality, what tools would you say you use, or how would you, you kind of just described it, but
yeah.
Can well, you elaborate
do,
drill, a little?
We do scenarios. We do everything from scenarios to role playing. And we actually show them through actual training. You know what I mean? Like not like just telling stories, but I tell stories right. too, but you know, so you actually can get a mental picture. But then I explain to them through a set of role playing scenarios as we go through them. And then sometimes they'll say, well, it seems contrived or set up, and it's not. It's just that, you know, it's based on psychology and biomechanics. And then what happens is they'll try this shit out there in real life in their police job, and they'll come back with these great stories. And some of them, if you go on my website, you'll see them on threatmanagementcenter.com. You'll see the enforcer tech system, and you'll see testimonials by police. You can actually do threat management. You can go to YouTube and Google or Google Threat Management Center police testimonials, and a lot of cops' testimonials will pop up there.
Yeah, I saw some of them.
A lot of cops are very negative, man, when they first, you know, encounter my program and encounter me in terms of the knowledge. They're like, ah, whatever, that's bullshit. I've been there, done that. And then what happens is they, you know, accidentally kind of listen on the side and then try it, and they come back like, wow, I didn't think that would work, and it worked great. And you know then they'll seek more, and then they're more way more positive, way positive. It's almost like they have to experience a negative situation. I mean, some of it's, you know, violence oriented. In other words, you know, I use this technique and it was a lot easier and I got control of the person. And and some of it is, you know, I wish I would have known this because of something terrible that happened to me. And of course, unfortunately, I know two police officers, both of which were bench pressing 500, 600 pounds, not necessarily without steroids, but both of them were interested in working with my organization. They just weren't interested in training. And in both cases, I did not allow that. And in both cases, they were killed by people that had zero skills compared to them, zero skills, no training with guns. And both of them were killed with guns by actual violent criminals. And, you know, it's unfortunate too, because they have families and kids, and it was horrible, man. And it's avoidable deaths. These police officers are dying in avoidable deaths. You know, that's the reason we teach is, you know, at the end of the day, when the police officers get killed and their families are negatively affected, that affects us as a society, as a community. It affects our bottom line, our money. We got to pay for that. We got to pay for the funerals. We got to pay for all the expenses for the family and the children. I mean, there's no, absolutely nothing good about having officers at risk where they're getting harmed, and then we all suffer, including their families. So my purpose in training them is to mitigate that, to reduce that risk, to reduce the injuries and killings of police officers, because none of us are going to win as a society having officers injured and or killed while they are injuring and or killing civilians for whatever reason. And so what we want to do is reduce the risk of death for everyone. And by doing so, we create a pattern of survivability for citizens and for the police. And that's the overall objective of the training and of my program, is not so much to, you know, point the finger at, you know, inappropriate individuals and outcomes, but really about changing it. You can change it. We can change it right now. And through training, through actual core competence-based training, we can create the confidence and the capability required to stop these avoidable killings and shootings of both the public and of the police. We just have to think differently. There's nothing about our current thought process that's going to change anything. We must change our thought process, then change our actions, changing our protocols, our policy.
I think we lost you there again.
It's, you know, hit or miss every day.
We lost you there again for a second.
Oh, but, okay.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. I mean, a lot of it, I think, also is people forget about, you know, to me, the police, you know, I don't think highly of the police, as you know, but they're the dogs of the politicians, the prosecutors, the judges, and people just see the police. They forget about the rest of the structure that really supports that. And I still blame police. I don't give them a pass because of fucking politicians, but they need to take just as much as the blame as the police do, although they don't, because people don't see them like they see the police.
Well, understand that. Let me tell you what I know for sure. No one controls the police, okay? No one. And so, you know, the politicians are being victimized by police. I know politicians are having problems with police officers. No one controls the police. And that's a severe and significant issue. The police cannot control the police. If you understood, like I said earlier, how many problems each police department has within it, you'd understand there is no blue line, man. It's a blue bunch of issues. And there's a lot of lawsuits. There's lots of problems, lots of clicks, lots of, you know, just, I mean, imagine this. In every single jurisdiction, there's some officer getting arrested and charged with crimes every day. And so that being said, the only way forward, man, is a complete overhaul, complete change, the change would actually help police officers a lot, because not only, for example, do I support them.
It looks like we lost you again there.
They should be training basically every week. They have to train constantly. This whole concept about initiating contact with people needs to be replaced. They should only be initiating contact with people that are threatening other people, pulling people around, pushing people and pulling them over and searching their pockets and all those kinds of behaviors. Just they create an adversarial interaction between them and the people that they serve. And it's counterproductive for the police and for the public. You don't need that. There's so many criminals out here that you really don't need to concentrate on criminalizing civilian behavior. There are actual violent criminals. We don't know this because we're not looking for them actively. We're looking for their victims, okay? And so until society decides that protection is more important than prosecution, we are going to be suffering. And that's where we're at right now. We are bleeding as a society, and everyone is suffering. To reverse it, all we have to do is change our perspective and our purpose and our performance, and everything will become more possible, more positive, and subsequently more prosperous for everyone.
I don't know how much of society at this point. I mean, there's definitely a big percentage, but is all about that. I mean, government in itself and politicians, you rarely hear them say anything about changing laws and knocking police. They'll say, well, we need to maybe change some things regarding their training or some shit like that. But you see what happens when they do say something, like the mayor of New York, who barely even said anything. All he said was he has a black son or half black son, and that he had to talk to him about the police. And then the police flipped out over it.
That's right. Yes, they did. And that's an example, man. The reality is, it's the system. It's not the officer. It's the system. That system that they're a part of, there's no, absolutely no control. So until you get rid of that system, you know, the police are not going to be manipulatable. They're not going to be relatable.
Right.
It's just not going to happen.
But I think it's the system as a whole, not even just the police part of it. I mean, I don't think
that system is based on. That system is based on people. And so one of the things that I found is libertarian people, the volunteerist people, the NAP people, the anarchist people, these people are the intelligentsia. They're more conscious, you know, except by everything except racism, but they're very conscious people. They're analytical. And what they don't realize in their analysis and in their intelligence is that they are a vast minority. They are a 1%.
Oh, they know that. I've never heard anybody who has those type of views think that they're some kind of, they know they're a tiny minority. They're aware that they're a minority. Trust me.
I get the vibe from them that a lot of them don't realize.
Maybe some of the people you talk to don't.
Honestly, man, they really don't know that the vast majority of people do not agree with liberty and volunteerists and NAP. And the majority of Americans are TAP, total aggression principle. Believe that anybody who's NAP is, not a person. You know what I mean? like just can't even imagine. You're like fucking against violence. Who the fuck are you? Like, they would kick my ass if they could. When I start talking about how you don't have to kill people who try to kill you. I mean, if I killed everybody who was a threat to me, man, I'd be a fucking extreme mass murderer. Reality is I found this peaceful way through bloodshed, through dealing with violence. And I found a better way. I didn't just make it up.
Looks like you went out there again.
And I own lots of guns. I love guns. It's just not necessary for public safety.
Yeah, I mean, I'd rather, I've said this before, that if somebody broke in my house, if by some reason, if they had a gun or something, if I ended up killing them, even though I don't think I'd be in the wrong, I'd still feel bad about it, and I would like it to be an avoidable situation. So, yeah, if I could avoid that situation, then I'd rather avoid that. On the other side of it,
We have air grenades. We have pepper grenades that can stop people from being able to breathe in your house. So imagine you hear somebody out there, you throw the fucking thing out there, they can't breathe. They can't steal when they can't breathe. And that is what we're talking about. If they wanted to assassinate you, they would use a bomb or sniper you.
Right.
If they are stupid enough to come in your house, they're probably a fucking teenager or a drug addict. They're not smart, obviously. Or they're, something personal and they're after you. The reality is, the better plan is to create a condition where they can't breathe. They can't see. You can't breathe and see, you can't really steal something. So, using smoke grenades, air grenades.
I'm not worried about the steal something, especially from me. I'm more worried about the personal safety, because you've said this before, and I agree with you to an extent. Like you had said, if somebody's stealing a TV, and you had talked about one of your people you're protecting and somebody's running away with a TV. You're like, well, what am I going to do? Kill somebody over a fucking TV? I mean,
right, man.
What's the point of that?
Exactly. And then at the end of the day, right, they have this great plan. That's a government plan. Okay. You got a fucking government plan. I love these guys that are like, I hate the government, but I want you to get my TV back. When I tell you how much it fucking cost to have me get your TV back, go to court and prosecute this guy, you are going to.
I would just want to, if you could get the TV back, just get it back and not hurt anybody, then yeah, but expensive. It's hard to do that.
This concept that the police are less expensive is insane. Listen, they're government workers, okay? The government bus, the government everything is cheaper than the private everything. When you get on a limo bus, that's private and it's expensive as shit. And when you get on a city bus, it's not expensive. When you get on the even Uber is an alternative, but it's a cheaper alternative. But you knew that when you signed up, you didn't care. You just want to get on a nice little car and just go. You didn't care. You didn't want a limo, or you didn't want metro cars. You wanted, a decent car and then go on where you got to go. And that's fine.
Because you have to
get luxury.
All that other shit is the government extorting your money, though. And this whole consent of the governed thing, and this fucking, the police are paid by extortion money. They are the extorters because they're the ones that back things up. Because bottom line is, government is based on the barrel of a fucking gun. And that's it. That's all. Right. It's the authority of government.
Right.
Government gets authority from one place. A bunch of guys with guns. That's it. Now, they don't have any authority.
Okay. Fair enough. Devil's advocate. Let's say that we had no police. How would we keep the masses from destroying the intelligentsia, people like you and the libertarian, the nat people, the smart people? How would we keep these masses of Americans that apparently, and I mean this from looking at Facebook and a lot of people that are the intelligentsia.
Yeah, I know you've had this conversation on many shows.
How would we stop them? I mean, I don't understand. Like,
I got an AR-15.
That's not enough, dude. That's not enough.
And an AK-47.
I'll give you 10. I'll give you 10 AR-15. You don't even shoot enough. These fucking guys shoot rabbits drunk for fun with a handgun at 100 yards. So, you know what I'm saying? Like, what would be the plan? You're not a war guy. You have to be a fucking war guy.
There's two things that you do, though. You are taking, and I know you're playing devil's advocate, but you're taking worst case scenario and you're taking the what if. But
you think it's the worst? I think it's not the worst.
Well, I mean, it could be worse than that, but I mean, you're taking the negative.
The situation. What do you think they would do? These guys that go out. Okay.
First of all, I don't have all the answers, and I never claim to have them. And I talk about things more in this is possible. Is this better than what we have now? And we don't know that for a fact. I know you have your experiences and you can base things off of your experiences, but you don't know if the whole, you know, as a society, it was more of a, you know, non-government, an organized society without a government or whatever.
Fair enough. Let me give you my frame of reference. Okay. That's a very good point.
But you do have experience in what you're doing to be able to come up with, well, I've ran into this and I've run into that, which gives you a more knowledgeable point of view to bring these things up. But on the other side of it, too, you're in extreme situations as well, or an extreme case, I guess. Well, because I think about this, and I made a note of this as well. Have Ann Arbor where you grew up. You said, you know, how nice it was and whatever. Though there was some racist people there. But I think things have changed in the past 20 years, too.
No, dude. It's not. It's fucking worse. It's getting worse. It's getting better.
You think people are more racist now than they were 20 years ago?
In a lot of ways, absolutely.
Not younger people.
You know what? Actually, man, quite a few are
you think so? I mean, I don't see it, but I don't go to high school anymore. Like, I grew up in Boston, and I saw racism.
Growing up, for example, where I grew up, you always have to have one black friend, and you're shit.
Well, I hung out with all the black kids in the school because there weren't a lot. It was maybe 5% black or something. You know, they called
me. All the cool white guys always had to have at least one good black friend, or you're like not.
Most of the white people didn't have black. There was the one black kid that hung out with all the white kids, but he was he was like called the Uncle Tom, and people talk shit about him. But they talk shit about him because they would call him nigga behind his back and talk shit, and they're like, why are you hanging out with these fucking kids? Like, I remember this one kid came up to me. You know, and they'd call me wannabe nigga and stuff like that. But he's like, you even smell like a nigga. Like, this is the shit I got, you know, growing up in high school.
What you should have remembered is,
that's a quote.
My frame of reference comes from the reality of what I experienced, man, throughout my life in different cities, different countries. When the masses are in a position to make a decision based on their group cultural thought process, usually in my case, you know, I'm outnumbered. I'm the non-Christian in the room full of Christians. That's my favorite. As they plot to attack me, luckily I can fight. And you know, so I'm always this atheist, or I'm the person who's not speaking the way the other people want to speak. I don't follow the suit, and therefore they resort to, right after, you know, trying to win a dispute with me intellectually, they then resort to, well, there's more of us, there's of you, so we're about to attack you. Then they find out, thank God, that I trained.
Yeah, see, I could fight to an extent, but I couldn't fight like you.
I had to learn, man, because I kept getting jumped. So well, I get better.
I got jumped a whole bunch of times as well, unfortunately.
Yeah, exactly. Well, that's what made me better, man. I was like, fuck that. I'm not.
But on the other side,
I don't even want to dominate. So you touch me, and I just want fucking suffering. Absolute dominance. And, you know, so I said, if there's going to be violence, I just want to be the most violent person in the room.
Right.
So that's why I kept training. Like, I didn't drink. I didn't smoke growing up. I just trained.
I drank.
Martial arts schools.
Smoke.
And I just, no, I just fucking smoked.
I sold it. but no, so, I would, you know, I weighed like, I was like 5'11 and I weighed 140 pounds. And, you know, on the other side of it, I've been jumped by a bunch of black kids three or four times, too. So it's, you know, and one of the times was because I was with a black girl that I was dating. So I've seen on both. I have a unique experience, to be honest, that a lot of people don't have. Now, I know it's not, you know, being black is totally different, and I'm not comparing it to that. But what I'm saying is, though, I'm not like somebody who, you know, doesn't know anything about, you know, what it feels like to be discriminated against. I can relate. But of course, you know, I didn't have to, but you know, I felt like that's who I was.
Yeah.
So,
the thing to remember, man, is that everything you experience, but imagine the system that's supposed to be supporting you as a student is not. Imagine the system that's supporting you as a person is not. Imagine the system supposed to be supporting you as a patient is not. So all those things you hold sacred as part of being a human being. Imagine those things being removed because people see you differently. And in my situation, I grew up around all white people, so I didn't even recognize it. I swear, I was like, oh, look, someone's acting odd. And I remember thinking, you know, it's not racism, I'm sure. It's got to be something else. It didn't even occur to me. Like, it couldn't be racism. And I remember people would say things to me, and I was like, whatever, it's not racism. It's bullshit. She doesn't like me or whatever. And so, you know. Or she doesn't like it, or whatever this is. It's never that. It's one of the things I never would believe. I would never believe racism is an issue. And because when you grow up with a certain group of people and they're the mass number of people, and that's who you consistently identify with because that's who you're with,
right.
Then, you know, you don't know you're different until the world shows you. And I mean, the world cannot wait to show me, man. I mean, I'm going to write a book just on that, man, because it's so pervasive. And I was so in denial. You know, my mother did that too. My mother was always like very into, you know, not addressing racial issues. And she was like some kind of anti-race warrior where she would always do things you're not supposed to do. Like we go to the Catholic church where she was Catholic. She went to Catholic private schools and African-American that was, you know, in her world, she believed that, you know, racism wasn't really there. She grew up wealthy. So she didn't know racism was real. And she went to a wealthy school where it wasn't posh to be racist. And, you know, so the reality is, you know, I'm a product of this mindset that racism is not real. And then I was dragged into the reality, kicking and screaming by the reality of the difference in my life. So we're not talking about like theoretical numbers. We're talking about what really happens. And it's pervasive, and it's across the board. I mean, it happens in every country, even. I was even in Germany, and the German cops were harassed me.
Yeah, I heard you talk about that.
The German cops were very nice when they harassed me, which is, you know, I mean, I can barely be mad.
I guess if you're
going
to get harassed, it's right. Better to get harassed nicely.
Yes, always. Oh, my God, yes. Hey, listen, nice harassment is always...
It's better than, you know, harassment, right?
Yeah,
but
yeah,
it's still harassment.
Sucks.
But, yeah, but I guess.
Yeah, you're right.
What I was trying to get to before that, when I brought up Ann Arbor and then Detroit, you lived in totally different places. You had different experiences as far as, okay, in general, yes, you experienced some racism. But my question is really not about racism. It's about the world in general, that Detroit is a kind of a fucked up place in a lot of ways, right?
And
Ann Arbor is, well, I'm more talking about just people in general and their propensity to be bad people.
Oh, and then you're talking about racism.
Well,
absolutely.
Absolutely, man.
What I'm saying is, because what you brought up about, you know, if there were no police and how many people would do bad things. So what I'm saying is, and that's why I'm saying I'm not totally talking about racism, you know, unless we're talking about it more, not it prejudice, but discrimination, because
racism is
acting on racism. You know, people can be racist and not act on it. It's when you act on it that racism to me is the hate. Discrimination is acting on it. It's when you don't hire somebody. You can be racist and not act on it.
Oh, yeah.
And it's your right. If you don't want to hang around a certain, I mean, I don't agree with it, but, you know, whatever. But if you, as long as you don't act on it, it doesn't really make a difference.
Yeah, but the reality is, what happens is it affects us in multiple layers and multiple ways, and it affects all of us. And racism, for example, you don't know you're being racist when you say things like, "Oh, Detroit is bad," right? Okay, so the reality is,
I'm basing off of what you said. Like, there's a lot of crime, right?
Well, actually, what you have is a lot of families being victimized by criminals because no one wants to protect them. The police refuse to protect them. And the reason I'm successful is because I protect people.
Right.
And the byproduct of that is wealth. Okay. And that's where I'm really disgusted with people on Facebook, is because what they're saying is the reverse. They're saying, look at this guy. He's successful and then he helps people. That's bullshit. I did not fucking say that. I said I help people. I keep them alive. I don't let them get raped, robbed, or killed. Then as
you just broke up there.
All of that positive lifestyle into a profitable situation, because rich people are getting richer and I make them pay for what I
right.
do. But I would do it, and I did do it without any money.
Right. No, I know that when you started out, you were putting
Well,
when you were starting out too. Oh, yeah, yeah. No, I know.
Right now.
Right.
Alive.
I'm sorry. I know that you do stuff for free. But I'm saying, even when you started out, you didn't get anything. Is what I mean. And you were out there endangering your life, and you thought you were going to die anyway. And
because I found out that no one wants to protect the families. No one's protecting the people.
What I'm saying is basically what you said is you went from Ann Arbor, this nice place, to Detroit, which you looked at totally differently. I'm using your words. I'm not taking and saying this is my opinion. I have no idea. I've been to Detroit Airport and I got arrested there.
You do have an idea though, man. It's not you. Listen,
but I'm taking it from your, you know what you're saying.
Actually, what you did was you're taking mine. But guess where you got it from? You got it mixed in with what the narrative is from media and TV and movies. And then you take what I say and then put it together without the meat, right? And the meat is, and I'm not saying you're doing something wrong. You just understand this is what we are doing in society.
Right.
This is what the racism is. It's not individual. It's not you doing something bad to me. So the racism is saying, I know this is wrong, right? It would be like a person in Afghanistan going, the fucking American people just bombed me. Okay. Yes, our tax dollars bombed you. Yes, they're Americans that dropped the bombs. And, okay, they're Christians. Okay, yes, they're Christians in the planes. But no, American Christians were not sitting around America going, dude, let's get some bombs, get some planes, let's go bomb Afghanistan. That's not what we did as a people and a society, right? And so the system did this. It's the system that's at work for various reasons. But to ignore the system that's creating these wars for profit, because no one's attacking any countries for nothing. It's all about money. So at the end of the day, the reason why we're never going to attack
Darfur. Well, America's an empire, and that's it is.
But our empire is based on money, not on anything.
It's not
else.
My empire.
So we're not going to go to Darfur any fucking reason.
Right, but what I mean is, you said like the police are different in Ann Arbor than they are in Detroit, right?
Yes, because the police in Ann Arbor are there to protect the students and the people.
So,
and in Detroit, the police are there specifically to not protect in general. Now, individual cops I know are protectors. They're just vastly outnumbered by the other officers who are there for different
reasons. So maybe I'm not explaining what my point enough. Is what I'm saying is, in general, where do you see society? Do you see it more like the, you know, like you look at the police in Detroit, and maybe that's the biggest problem compared to Ann Arbor. But what I'm saying is you have a whole huge country of 320 million people. And if you had no police and no government, and we had a, you know, organized society, like I said, I don't have all the answers, but there's certain, you know, I could go into certain things and certain setups. Mm-hmm. Now, do you, what percentage of people do you believe are bad people that would, you know, do all these things? And that's what I'm saying. Okay, you have two different experiences.
Very good point. Now, let me shed some light on you. It's the good people that are fucking way worse than what we call the bad people. The good people are the ones that you would say are going to grab the white women who own land and find out if they're witches by killing them. It's the good Christians that did that, not the fucking criminals.
Well, I don't consider people good people because they're Christians. I'm talking about...
I'm not, it's not about you, man. Listen,
and I don't consider drug dealer bad people.
Okay, wait. I'm not talking about you.
I know.
You as America, okay?
I know. America.
All right, you're an enlightened person.
But,
I'm talking
about us. I'm talking about
you. I don't mean you.
I'm not talking about America. Fuck what Americans think. I'm talking about what me and you think about the percentage of people that we would have to worry about there were no police. Because you have an experience, I think, that is jaded to an extent.
Okay,
that
so
you've seen
no police,
a lot of bad people. And I'm talking like police are bad people. Okay, the police are bad people.
Fuck that, man. Listen, the worst people are the good ones.
That's what
ones
I mean.
Me
and, you, and you've
they
run
want
in.
Me to fuck over like white guys that have dreads. They want me to fucking kill the white poor people. They want me to fucking follow the black people, black poor kids. And I mean, these are good citizens, good Americans.
Well,
good
considered Muslims, by them, right?
Yeah, no, good by American standards. By standards, they went to college.
That doesn't mean
fucking,
shit.
Let me tell you something. The white man who fucks a black lady, makes a fucking baby, they're fucking married. He says to me, there's a fucking guy you got to watch. Now, this is a law enforcement professional executive with an advanced college degree from one of the top universities in our country, who is married to a black woman. He is a mature white man in his 50s. He is a law enforcement executive professional who's been around black people his whole professional career. He says to me, and he likes me, he is very supportive of my organization. Hey, we have a dangerous person over here. We need to follow him. He's African-American, dressed in all black, and he's got some things in his hands, and he's over here. I'm following him now. Okay?
And what's his basis, just because of that description?
He's a fucking black man in all black.
That's what I mean. He didn't know. There was nothing else that he knew about this guy. That was his only.
Yes, okay. Yes. Now, even from that description, right, this law enforcement professional, executive, who's in charge now of something above law enforcement, just to be clear, who is a friend of mine. he follows this man for 45 minutes. I don't get there because I already know he's not a criminal. I know he's not a criminal because this is what I do. Like if you were a bear hunter and I said that I'm following a bear, it has antlers, you'd fucking know it's not a bear. So I already knew this was not a criminal, but I have to show up for political reasons, right? I get there. It's a fucking judge. He's wearing a black suit. It's called a sweatsuit. And the things in his hands are called weights. Now, just because he fucks a black woman and makes a mixed baby, just because he's articulate, intelligent, went to college, and is a very, very soft-spoken Christian who goes to church every week and never cusses like me, does not mean he is not an evil person.
Right.
He is a good person who will do evil shit way more than anybody who's a drunk crackhead on the side of the street. That guy will never call me and say, let's follow a judge and see if we can stalk him. He'll never do that.
Well, that's
so
discrimination.
Our concept that we are somehow the good people are the good people and the bad people are the bad people is total bullshit. When the only person that blew people up in our country for 20 years was a Unabomber who was a college professor, a pillar of society.
Right, but
so my point is our reality has been swayed to believe socioeconomic status and some other things are key, our key factors. Listen, there's no such thing as a fucking lieutenant, uneducated, who thought of these different scams to get cops out of shit.
So
these
what
college professional police officers that are coming up with different concepts to help the lower echelon officers get out of trouble.
90% of the fucking government, it probably 99% of, I mean, look at the CIA, look at the FBI, look at them all. I mean, they're all criminals. So what I'm saying, I guess, never mind the good and bad label, what percentage of people would we have to, you know, using something that you say a lot, you know, human predators? I mean, how many people are human predators that we have to worry about?
All humans in your opinion. Predators. All humans are predators. When those white girls
at
white college decided to do hazing and kill other white girls at college, they're not evil. They're just human predators who got out of control in a hazing incident and resulting in the death of another Christian white girl from their community that was trying to be a sorority sister. So we really got to get away from the concept that the people that would kill us, that would hunt us, that would harm us, are these evil people. Do you think when someone went to sit their child from middle America, upper middle class family, to a college, that they thought their daughter was going to be killed at a sorority? It never occurred to them. How about rape at a college? It never occurred to them. How about rape in the
ignorant
army? You know how many girls get fucking raped in army? It's unfucking believable. And so how about boys that get raped in the army or in the Navy? So the point is, once we understand that, like I'll give an example, went to Hurricane Katrina. I took a team to Hurricane Katrina the first weekend that it happened. Okay. So down there you had a missing government. When I say missing, I mean, they fucking locked down and decided, fuck you. We're not doing anything. They were scared to death of the black people, essentially. And then the corporations came into play.
At some point they started taking people's guns.
So the corporations got into play. Okay. Now, what the corporations did was they hired people to commandeer vehicles and to rescue their people from their corporate headquarters. Like, I'm not going to name the name, but they took.
All you got to do is look up big corporations in New Orleans. You can probably figure
In New Orleans, you'll know. They hired fucking mercenaries to go down there and secure their buildings, secure their executives, and to escort them out. And those fucking guys were fragged. They were killing people left and right. They drew down on cops. They had shootouts with police officers. The gangsters, the thugs, actual thugs, they had a heyday. They literally, as a large group with AKs and other weapons, decided that they would be taking women at will and children and rape. They were not in gangs, also did the same thing. Men that were not in gangs had children on top of a building inside of a school, and they were raping them for 2 to 3 days. And these were not in a gang. These are just guys.
That's crazy.
Yes. And so the good people were shooting people, having shootouts. And so that's one example. Okay. And the government was no better until the end, when this African-American general came in and said, put your fucking guns down. Put all the fucking guns down and rescue the fucking people. So with the right government worker, we were able to get some help. With the wrong government worker, those fucking guys took the children, separated from their parents. Hundreds of children have never been returned to their parents.
God, never. That's fucked up.
That's fucked up. And people were screaming for help. Dead bodies were inside the dome. And so nobody wants to admit that. Spike Lee didn't want to admit that. Fucking the police, they once they realized it was going to be their fault, they didn't admit it. 75% of the police quit day one. 75% of the police quit as soon as it was violent, as soon as they realized that it was not it's not going to be an easy, tenable situation. 75%. I want you to think about that for a second. Walked off the job. Now,
it means they don't give a fuck, for one.
Well, they give a fuck about themselves.
So right. They don't give a fuck about anything, any their job or.
That is their job.
Wow. Right.
Get it? Remember? So, see, what happens is we have a perception from TV, right?
Well,
it's fucking with our head. It's fucking with our head.
No, I think they do their job, because I believe their job is to lock up, fill jails, and make money for the fucking government and harass people and put them down and train them to be obedient. So I think they do their job.
Honestly, man, it's not even that. If you try to tell them what to do, they won't. In fact, if the government told them you better fucking do it, guess what they'd do? They wouldn't do it because they were told to. See, that's where this is all getting twisted.
They can always fire them.
I'm sorry?
They can always fire them and find people
they can't. Are you fucking kidding? They can't. They fucking, this is the thing that's missing, man, reality. You fucking fire these cops and watch what happens to you. Okay? You can't fucking just fire them. First of all, they have a union.
True.
Guns. And it's a bunch
of them. It is hard to fire cops.
If you think
cops.
You're going to come along and fire, listen, the FBI comes along and disbands police departments sometimes, okay? When they find them in cahoots and too deep, they actually come and just shut, every year they do this, man, across our country.
Yeah, I've heard of a police station that got shut down. Yeah.
Dude, it's across the fucking country because there's just no way to rebuild it. They just shut the whole fucking thing down.
Yeah.
Disbanding was not a joke in Ferguson. That was always on the table. The point is, once you disband it, who comes in? If the county is worse or the state is worse, then it just gets worse. You exacerbated your problem.
Yeah.
And that is, and so for example, let's say you have, and so this whole thing about African-American cops too, total fucking bullshit.
That's why you get rid of the police altogether.
Well, no. When you get rid of the police altogether, now you have a really good situation. Now you have mass mob mentality where you can literally kill the African-Americans in large scale groups as well as their friends. So white people that are friends with black people will be killed immediately, beaten, killed. So these, you know, what happens is the masses, and I guarantee you that these bikers, these one percenters, let me give you an example. One of the things they do here in Detroit, I won't name which one it is, but they know who they are. They fucking grab black people and throw them off a bridge here sometimes for fun. And they're never prosecuted, never fucked with. They're right in downtown. They're right in the heart of Detroit. And black people that are walking by are thrown off of a bridge onto traffic that's down below. Police mysteriously don't need to, investigate too much. And it's never in the media. That information came from one of the presidents of the biker group. It's a national group. And their stepson worked for me. And he told me a bunch of their secrets. Yeah. And so this is just a reality of what the masses would do, man. When I went down to Hurricane Katrina, dude, 100 of the officers that we encountered were just people that had a t-shirt on, and the initials from the sheriff's department locally was put on there with a magic marker. This gave them the right to go around and grab people, shoot them, rape girls, all kinds of stuff they were doing. And these were commandeered, regular, deputized citizens, okay? Deputized by what you would consider a sheriff that is constitutional, okay? They declared martial law. Any federal agents, local police that showed up would be shot on sight if they crossed their bridge during this time of issue. The only reason we got a pass is because we protected, that we just happened to come across their helicopter that was coming down. And I think they thought we were federal because my staff is multicultural. Anytime you see black and white people pretty much working together in an organized fashion with professional equipment, they automatically think federal. So everybody thought we were feds. Even the feds thought we were feds. And it was really weird. They were like, hey, how you guys doing?
If it works, hey.
Whatever. They just saw, I had a guy with, it was tall, bald head looking, like he was a Aryan Nation member. And he was driving the Hummer and I was in the back. And they was like, oh shit, these guys are serious. And so we had no problem getting through checkpoints. This is the first weekend that the fucking storms happened, man. There was no communication. I was introduced to the kill zones that the different communities set up for the blacks trying to get out of New Orleans. Okay. So if they were to get on like a boat or they would try to drive out somehow, they would be fucking shot. Okay. It was, they had kill zones and the SEAL team was actually deployed there. Which I did not believe. I thought this guy was fucking with me. There was I thought he was lying and joking or like, I don't know, bullshitting. He was actually the master. Yeah. And he fucking asked me to use my Hummer to pull Zodiacs over the levee. And what we did instead was I had one of my staff members jump the fence and get the levee opened up, the levee, the actual levee doors,
to the locks. I'm sorry, to the locks. The locks are gas operated. They're not electric. So when the electric grid went down, it didn't matter because these are gas operated. They're filled with gas. And I mean, they have tons of fuel. those locks could be working for like months without any power. And, you know, from the power grid, they have their own individual, you know, power sources. Yeah. But that's how we got the Navy SEALs in there. And, you know, I remember thinking, why, you know, afterwards, an afterthought, why the fuck were the Navy SEALs even here?
Yeah. Maybe that was a bad idea.
Dude, at that time, I'm just trying not to.
You don't know, but you find out later, man, maybe that was a bad idea.
Yeah, yeah, but you know what? Hey, fuck that. I'm just trying not to end up living in Louisiana on a chain gang.
Right.
myself. You know what I'm saying? Like, seriously, I just got to try to get my people in and out of here so we can help people and get out of here. One Mississippi Trooper.
Which was a very noble thing in the first place, just to go, that you didn't have to have anything to do with that, but you.
No, absolutely not.
You did that totally on your own just because you wanted to help.
Because the government was not helping. So the people have to help the people. And there's no money. I never got any dollars back. No one ever, you know, supported me. There was no kickbacks from the government. I just took my money, and I took all of my money that I had to my name, and I went in Hummers and vehicles, and I took my team down there. And my team members volunteered. We had no money, and we could have died. This is what it takes for society to function, is we have to sacrifice for each other. If that was your family, what would you do? That's all you got to do, man. Just remember, somebody's family.
That's what I know you always say, that look at everything like the people are your family members. But that's all the time we got for tonight. I think that's a great note to end on. And, of course, you know, I know you got plenty more stories and stuff to talk about. So,
yes, sir.
Starting September 12th, every Monday at 5:30 Pacific, 8:30 Eastern, Dale will be on talking about whatever he wants to talk about. But more stuff like this and whatever's going on and whatever he, you know, feels like talking about. So, definitely tune in, and more information to come. Of course, you know, I'll announce a lot more about it, and we'll try to promote as much as possible as well. So, you know, there's so much more.
Yeah, it's like, much more to share.
That's like a little. Basically, even though you were on for a while, that's like a teaser of all the stuff that you know, Dale can talk about, and he's a smart guy too. So it's not, you know, just about the threat management center. I mean, he can go into issues on anything
into. The whole point is to evolve and get better, man. To learn more. And to make better decisions so we can all have a better quality of life. Let me be clear about my purpose in sharing is, you know what, if I did something stupid, if I, you know, made mistakes, which I did, then what I want to do is share with you what I learned so we can make better decisions together so people don't have to learn what I did the wrong way. A lot of thought process went into failure and then I have solution.
And then you learned from
20
it.
Years. But imagine doing it every day, man. Imagine every day blaming yourself for a negative outcome, and then saying, you know what, tomorrow I'm going to do it differently and better, and then do that every single day.
Yeah, and a lot of people would have given up, and you didn't. So
No, you know what else it was,
you
man?
Know, give you a I lot really, of credit.
I didn't have a choice. Let's be clear. I did not have a choice, and maybe
well,
if I had a
you
choice.
You did. It's not like, you know, in all honesty, if you wanted to go back to college or something, I'm sure your parents would have helped you. It's not like you know what I mean?
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
It's not like you came from the ghetto and like you had no options.
Did you talk to my mother or something? Did she tell you to tell me that?
No, but I'm saying, like, I'm sure if you went back, hey, Mom, this isn't working out. I want to go to college now. I'm sure she would have been like, sure. And you know what I mean?
No, she's been like,
so you didn't have to. That's what makes you more, I mean, even more like, you know, because somebody who really doesn't have a choice and that's all they got.
Right.
Like,
right.
You had other options where you didn't have to do this shit. And you did it anyway.
And my mother pointed that out every day.
She's probably like, what are you doing? Like, right. You're putting you're going to die. And you can go to college and be whatever.
Yeah, I come from a family of doctors, man. My family started the first privately owned African-American hospital. My great-grandparents were both doctors. My grandfather and grandmother both owned a hospital. It was handed down to them. My mother is a doctor, and my little sister's a doctor. So I come from all doctors.
That's what I'm saying, that you had other options, and you wanted to help people so much that you put there's not a lot of people that – I don't know anybody like that, to be honest. I mean, I'm sure there's somebody somewhere.
Funny,
man?
You know what's funny? My mother would say, you need to go to college. You need to go back to college. You need to go to – I never – you know. I'm an educationally abortive individual, right? So I also make more money than all of them combined. So now I'm valid. Now I'm valid, by the way. My mother does not believe I should go back to college. Like last 5 years, now that my house is bigger than all of their houses and my cars are nicer.
It took a while, but hey.
No, it's all bull crap. The reality is, you know what? You should judge
you shouldn't be judged
what,
on that. I mean,
yeah, no, exactly, man. Who cares?
You should be judged day, on putting yourself you out there, man. If you would have failed, then you would have failed.
What did you do to make the world a better place, man? Yeah. What did you do? You know what I'm saying? Like, I love the fact that we actually go into people's lives. We erase a rape, a robbery, a killing from happening to a family tree. We erase it, make sure it never happens. And we do that by physically intervening in predatory situations, not letting predators attack people, and it's a great feeling.
It's like changing the future before.
It is, man. It's so beautiful. It's a beautiful thing, man.
Going back in time.
Yeah, it is, man. It's so, because it's an imminent thing. And what's amazing, man, is that we came from a place where, you know, it's so funny, my guys from, you know, the 90s or so, they think it's hilarious because, you know, we had problems with law enforcement back in the 90s, right? And now, the chief of police speaks highly of my organization. Now the prosecutor's office speaks highly of us. The judges are speaking highly of us. And they literally send people to us if they think they're going to be killed. And they say threat management center can help you. The threat managers, they'll come out and protect you guys.
Yeah, I know you had mentioned before that, you know, initially you had a lot of trouble on when you were on before. And, you know, now it's probably took you a while, but at least, you know, now you have them more on your side and everything.
Yeah, they're totally positive, man. But they were very problematic in the 90s, mid-90s.
They were trying to sabotage you.
They were totally trying to sabotage and stop me. And then what happened was that the executives found out, the administrators of law enforcement saw the stats, and they were like, wait a minute, let's stop any harassment of this organization. There's nothing negative in the media, and yet our stats are showing safer neighborhoods.
Yeah, so it made them look better.
Yes, yes.
And they didn't give a shit about you. They're just like, we look better. Exactly. let's keep this guy going. He's making us look better.
And my thing is, you know what? I don't care about me. Let's use that, man. You know what? If that's what it takes for you to support our endeavors of helping people, I'm fine with that, man. Like, you know, we get sometimes with a situation where cops will show up like, oh, we got this. Great. So you got...
No, you kind of went out there, but
instead of the police, listen, if the police will do their job and they'll, you know, help the family, I'm all for it. If not, I'm going to help that family.
Yeah, most likely they're not going to do it, but
yeah, unfortunately, no. But you know what's funny? I swear to you, over the last like year and a half, 2 years, the police have been more responsive. Like every time we show up, the police are like, no, we got it. I'm like, okay, great.
That's cool.
I'm not trying to.
Maybe they're trying to prove something to you, like, hey, we're better.
Yeah,
that's good, though, because you're creating see, that's the whole thing. They have a monopoly on force, and that's the problem. And hopefully,
you know, honestly, it's all ego. It has nothing to do with the business at hand.
No,
it's
I'm sure
it's all ego. No, that's my point. Is it's about people. These individuals feel something, and what they're feeling is, I should be doing that. Okay, then they step up and say, "Ma'am, I will take care of you. Fuck those guys."
Well,
and I don't care, you know.
If
fine.
You can get if that's how you get them to do it, then
exactly,
whatever.
Exactly.
Who gives a fuck?
That's my point.
It's
man.
The outcome that matters.
Yes,
right?
Exactly. I don't care who saves the family. This is somebody saved the family, and there's no competition. That's my point. Is we got to get across that when we're dealing with predators. Now, if we're dealing with like safety for your parking lot or you know a guard at your door, okay. I mean, I can see competition with that. If we're talking about life and death,
No one's competing for that. I'm sorry. Right. Would you like to go up against the active gunman today? We'll give you a $25 bonus. I mean, what the fuck? Really?
Well, when I say competition and if the free market, I just mean that these people won't do it. So, you know, you find somebody else that can. What happens is with the police, and okay, I got to go okay after this, is with the police is you can't really get somebody else to do it. You guys have been able to do it to an extent.
Okay. Let me add one thing. Let me add one thing. Think of it instead of two things. Think of it as a different thing. So when you go to get, for example, something the government supplies, like lighting, right? But then you say, you know what? I want better lighting. So you take your money and you buy a better lighting system.
But you don't have that option with the police, really. You do kind of now that you guys are around.
Every single person has bodyguards that can afford them. And that's the point is, we can, if we cumulatively think of ourselves as worthy of bodyguarding, we could do that. Law enforcement is not something anyone can compete with because it has no actual function other than the enforcement of law.
Well, that's why they shouldn't exist.
No. They have to because you need people to enforce laws. Like, I'm not going to ever fuck with
you. Yeah, but there's too many.
You don't turn your radio down. I guess you could be sued by your neighbor. But
there's too many laws. We have serious problems with laws, and that's a whole other issue.
I totally agree with you. Let's talk about that next time. That's a good
point.
Too many fucking laws, and that's what's creating overload, information overload for police, mission overload for police. And
they don't even know the fucking laws. They looked them up on me to find something to arrest me for. They wanted to arrest me, so they had to go to their computer and look it up.
Oh, absolutely. And then guess what else? They still don't know it. And guess what? We don't know it.
No, they arrested me for something that wasn't a crime. Luckily,
yes,
this is the only situation where, I lost out, obviously, because I had to sit at the police station and pay $3,000 bail. I got it back in a month. But at least the DA didn't press charges because to fuck with me.
Dude, listen. So, I don't know what your situation was, but remember this.
That's a long story, but
with African-Americans, what they'll do is they'll say, I know we were wrong on the one thing, but here's what we'll do. We'll give you a misdemeanor on this other shit that's not real, and we'll let the other stuff go if you'll take the misdemeanor. What the fuck? Really? Like, really? You know you're wrong about the whole thing. I mean, I've been through...
They arrested me and charged me. Just real quickly, another case, I had bruises all over me, obstruction of an officer, which just means you pissed them off, just because I asked them why they were put a gun to my head on private property and were asking me to get out of my car. And the judge found me guilty, and then I had to pay a lawyer to appeal. I appealed all the way to the Supreme Court, and they wouldn't take it. So I got fucked. I got the maximum fine of $1,000. They wanted me to go to jail. So I'll talk to you about that later sometime off air. Thanks for coming on, and I'm really excited about you doing your own show. One thing to improve on is we need to improve on the connection and the sound for next time. Of course, I won't be on, but we'll still have that. We got to figure out a better way to connect you to the airwaves.
I'm going to have a better mic system and everything next time.
So we'll be good by. We still got almost a month, so we'll be good by then. So definitely, everybody will give you some more information. But it's Mondays, September 12th is the first show at 5:30 Pacific, 8:30 Eastern. And again, thanks again, Dale. And what's your website?
Our website is threatmanagementcenter.com. That's T-H-R-E-A-T, threatmanagementcenter.com. And we're also on YouTube.
Yeah,
we have 500 videos on YouTube.
Go to YouTube and type it in. And you can even watch some of the interviews with other shows as well. I would suggest that because they're not that all the interviewers are great, but Dale does a great job and gives a lot of information. So watch some of those as well. So, all right, Dale, thanks again,
man.
Take care.
All right, appreciate you, man. Thank you. Talk to you later.
Bye-bye. So that's all for tonight. Again, that's like a teaser for Dale's show, man. It's definitely going to be a great show. I mean, I'm really excited about it. So hopefully you enjoyed it, and I'm sure you'll enjoy stale show when it comes on. So have a good night, everybody, and have a good weekend.
But at the end of the day, each and every member is to go home safe. Sometimes the use of force is necessary. You need to comply with the police officer. The way the system...